Representative Luisa, Vice Chair Luisa Loren Quaresma, Representative Princess Sakaluran, Representative Celso Regencia, Representative Joseph Tan, Representative Raul Manuel, Representative Mohammed Paglas, Representative Salvador Plato, Representative Solomon Chungalao, Representative Florence Reyes, Representative Drixie May Cardema, Representative Jefferson Congun, Representative Bonifacio Bosita, Representative Faustino D., Representative Yasser Balindong, Representative Alfel Baskug, Representative Arnan Panaligan, Representative Patrick Vargas, Representative Samantha Santos, Representative Muhammad Dimaporo, Representative Arlene Rosas, Representative Siti Amina Dimaporo, Representative Leandro Madrona, Representative Romeo Acop, Representative Josefina Taliado, Representative Jolo Revilla, Representative Wowo Fortes, Representative Fernando Cabredo, Representative JJ Romualdo, Representative Isidro Lumayag, Representative Dale Corvera, Representative Filimon Aspares, Representative Eddie Bong Plaza, and Representative JC Abalos. Joining us via Zoom, we have Deputy Speaker Aurelio Dong Gonzalez Jr., Deputy Speaker Isidro Ungab, Deputy Majority Leader Antonio Tonipet Albano, Deputy Majority Leader Lianda Bolilla, Deputy Majority Leader Lawrence Defensor, Vice Chairperson Jose Alvarez, Vice Chairperson Maria Richelle Arenas, Vice Chairperson Claudie Bautista, Vice Chairperson Carl Nicolas Cari, Vice Chairperson Angelica Natasha Co, Vice Chairperson Christopher De Venecia, Vice Chairperson Gerardo Jerry Boy Espina Jr., Vice Chairperson Ed Christopher Go, Vice Chairperson Roy Loyola, Vice Chair Maria Lucille Nava, Vice Chairperson Alfonso Umali, Vice Chairperson Ana Marie Villarasa Suarez, Vice Chairperson Alan Uy, Vice Chairperson Maria Carmen Zamora, Vice Chairperson Jose Maria Subiri Jr., Vice Chair Ching Bernos, Representative Maria Vanessa Aumentado, Representative Alfilito Alfal Baskug, Representative Edgar Chato, Representative Representative Jaime Coanco, Representative Ambrosio Cruz, Representative Ricardo Cruz, Representative Solomon Sungalao, Representative Ernesto Junicio Jr., Representative Antonieta Yudela, Representative Jaime Presnedi, Representative Wowo Fortes, Representative Maria Angela Garcia, Representative Edwin Garjola, Representative Anthony Rolando Goles Jr., Representative Cheris Ann Hernandez, Representative Carmelo John B. Lasatin II, Representative Antonio Ligarde Jr., Representative Gerville Luistro, Representative Edward Vera Perez Maceda, Representative Jesse Mangawang, Representative Doris Maniquez, Representative Maria Rene Ann Lourdes Matibag, Representative Agustina Dominique Dice Tinapancho, Representative Ramon Jolo Revilla, Representative Marvin Rillo, Representative Dimsar Sali, Representative Richelle Singson, Representative Joseph Tan, Representative Rosana Ria Vergara, Representative Samuel Versosa Jr., Representative Christopher Sonyap, Representative Adrian J. Advincula. We have also Representative Maria Sinchachan, Representative Edsel Galeos, Representative Edward Hagedorn, Representative Lani Mercado Revilla, Representative Peter Miguel, Representative Jerny Jet Nisay, Representative Jose Gay Padjermos, Representative Rufus Rodriguez, Representative Edgardo Salvame, Representative Reynaldo Tamayo, Representative Lodi Odi Tariela, Representative Yevgeny Vicente Emano, and from the DILG, may we acknowledge the presence of the Secretary, Attorney Benjamin Abalos Jr., Undersecretary for Local Government, Marlo Iringan, Attorney Lord Villanueva, Undersecretary for Operations, Attorney Margarita Gutierrez, Undersecretary for Plans, Undersecretary for Peace and Order, Oscar Barinzuela, Undersecretary for Public Safety, Serafin Barreto Jr., Assistant Secretary for Plans and Programs, Francisco Cruz. Assistant Secretary Esther Aldana for Administration, Finance, and Controllership. Executive Director of the Local Government Academy, Telma Vicina. OIC Secretary for Local Government and Director of DLGS, Attorney Odilon Pasaraba. Chief of the PNP, Police General Rodolfo Asurin Jr. Vice Chairperson, Executive Officer of the NAPOLCOM, Attorney Alberto Bernardo. Chairperson and CEO of NYC, Ronald Gian Carlo Cardema. Executive Director, PCW, Attorney Christine Rosary Yuson Chavez. Secretary of the National Commission for Muslim Filipinos, Giling Mamonjong. Police Brigadier General Fernando Sevilla, President of the PPSC. Director Alan Iral of the BJMP. Director Louis Porakan, Chief of the Bureau of Fire Protection. Police Major General Jesus Cambay of PNP-TDC. Police Major Emmanuel Peralta of PNP-TADO. We also have Under Secretary for Mindanao Affairs and Special Concerns, Attorney Alfredo Bayan. Under Secretary for External and Legislative Affairs, Attorney Juan Victor Llamas. Under Secretary for Barangay Affairs, Felicito Balmosina. Assistant Secretary for Human Resource Development, Florida Dihan. Assistant Secretary for Community Participation, Elizabeth Lopez De Leon. And Assistant Secretary for Peace and Order, Duavili Rancho. That's all, Madam Chairperson and Chairman.
The ILG Secretary, Attorney Benjamin Benhor Abalus Jr., sir. PNP Chief General Rodolfo Asurin, and other officials of the Department of the Interior and Local Government, heads of the attached agencies and units, members of this august body, mga kababayan, magandang araw po sa ating lahat. A road to optimum economic recovery and attaining the fulfillment of our agenda for prosperity lies in the enhancement of the capacity of LGUs to efficiently perform devolved services and functions towards greater devolution. Through the budget, we must strengthen LGU's capacity to recover from the socio-economic impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic. Institutionalize LGU preparedness and resilience to the natural disasters and in managing risk and crisis. Prioritize and address the needs of women, youth, and Muslim Filipinos. And finally, step up the fight against insurgency, criminality, and illegal drugs to ensure people's safety. We must strengthen the department's internal capacity and resiliency to effectively fulfill its mandate and comply with various presidential directives. To the DILG family, we look forward to seeing a budget that will respond to these challenges. Thank you and good day, everyone. I would like to inform the good secretary of DILG and the vice chairperson that the vice chairperson in charge of your budget is the distinguished lady from the Lone District of Nueva Ecija. Vizcaya, Representative Luisa Loren Banti Quaresma. She will be in charge of all your concerns and in defending your budget at the plenary. Madam Vice Chairperson, any opening statement before we proceed with the presentation of the department?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and to everyone, good morning. It's an honor and privilege to have been given again this task of being a vice chairperson in the House of Representatives, defending again the budget of the Department of Interior and Local Government. Even in the previous Congress, in the 17th and 18th Congress, I was again the one in charge of the budget of the Department of Interior and Local Government. That's why I thank the Honorable Speaker of the House, the Honorable Martin Romualdez, the Majority Floor Leader, Manix Dalipe, and of course, our very energetic chairperson, the Honorable Elizaldico, for giving me this opportunity again to be in charge of the budget of the DILG. Now, I would like to inform everyone that my co-sponsor for the budget of the DILG are as follows. We have Vice Chairperson, the Honorable Jose Aquino of the 1st District of Agusan del Norte, and the Honorable Vice Chair Person Arnie Quintabella of the 4th District of Camarines. So I hope that in today's deliberation or budget briefing of the DILG, it will be a fruitful activity or a fruitful one. So to the family of the DILG, welcome to the House of Representatives. And now I would like to request the Secretary Attorney Benjamin Abalos Jr. to now proceed with your presentation. If there's a way that the Secretary or your presentation will be just that brief, para naman hindi tayo magtatagal dito, because there are a lot of congressmen who will be like already in the list, who will be asking question or to interpolate the family of the DILG. Secretary Abalos, you may now proceed, please.
Thank you so much, Vice Chairperson Congressman Quaresma. I would like to greet our Chairperson, Honorable Elizaldico, of course, our Majority Floor Leader, Honorable Manix Dalipe, all of the members of this House Committee on Appropriations, and all of the congressmen, congresswomen, present, ladies and gentlemen, magandang umaga po. The DILG's drive for good governance, peace and order, and public safety will remain strong and steadfast in 2023, as our role becomes more relevant at a time when we transition to a new administration, overcome the lingering effects of the COVID-19 pandemic, and as LGUs continue their own transition into a landscape where they are expected to deliver more and quality services brought about by the Supreme Court ruling on full devolution. For the next 6 years, our department's priorities are anchored on the UNITE agenda, which is synonymous and supportive of the President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s call for the country and the people to work as one to overcome the numerous challenges in front of us for the development of the country. Allow me to break down what our own UNITE means. Letter U, unleash the maximum potentials of LGU towards good local governance, which is crucial as they manage additional resources due to the High Court's favorable decision on the Mandanas Garcia's petition, as well as accompanying high expectation by the people for better quality service delivery. Letter N, nourish demands of national and local governments in addressing key sectoral concerns affecting every Filipino community. Letter I, innovate governance processes and systems through the automation and the use of ICT to further improve the delivery of public services to every Filipino, as this is the key to improving public service, minimize human intervention, and thus lesser opportunities for corruption and possibly more investments and businesses in every LGU. Lastly, letter E, enhance the capabilities of the department and our attached agencies to meet these priorities and other emerging challenges headed our way, both in the local governance and peace and order and public safety fronts. As such, Our proposed budget for 2023 shall be wisely and judicially spent to achieve our trust and priorities, namely, enhancing LGU capacities in the efficient delivery of devolved services and functions, strengthening LGU's capacities to recover from the socioeconomic shocks and impacts of the pandemic, number three, institutionalizing LGU preparedness and resilience to disaster as well as in managing risk and crisis, number four, prioritizing and advancing the rights and interests of the youth, women, and children, and Muslim Filipinos. Next is stepping up the fight against insurgency, criminality, and illegal drugs, our triumph of which shall help about bring development and stability to our communities and to the lives of our people, and strengthening the department's internal capacity to carry out its mandates and comply with various presidential directives and priorities. This initiative shall be pursued using the 251 billion pesos budget allotted to the DILG, which happens to be a mere 0.70% higher compared to our current appropriation of 249 billion. May I turn over the microphone to Yusek Eringan, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Secretary, to the Honorable Chair and members of the House Appropriations Committee, to my colleagues in the Department of Interior and Local Government. Good morning, everyone. May I continue what the good Secretary started? The breakdown of the DILG's budget proposal for 2023 per agency is as follows. As shown, six agencies of the Department have lower budget allocations for 2023 as compared to their current appropriations, namely the Office of the Secretary, which covers the operations of our central, regional, and field offices, the Local Government Academy, National Police Commission, National Commission on Muslim Filipinos, the National Youth Commission, and the Philippine Commission on Women. The remaining four agencies have registered an increase from their current budget levels. These are the following: the Philippine Public Safety College, the Bureau of Jail Management and Penology, the Bureau of Fire Protection, and the Philippine National Police. Also, 87% of our budget goes to personnel services, while 12% goes to maintenance and other operating expenses, and 1% for capital outlay. On a per agency basis, this is the breakdown of our budget. May we point out that five of our agencies were not given budget allocation for capital outlay in 2023. May we now provide the highlights of our 2023 fiscal year budget per expense class. Our budget for personnel services will be for retirement and gratuity for the retirees of the Philippine National Police, the Bureau of Fire Protection, and the BGMP, for terminal leave benefits of 1,447 compulsory retirees, loyalty pay, creation of 2,000 Fire Officer 1, 2,000 Jail Officer 1, 1,000 Patrolman and Patrol Women, as well as 200 Philippine Public Safety Academy cadets, and the filling up of 18,000 unfilled positions in the PNP, the BFP, and the BGMP. Our MOE will be for the following: implementation of projects that will enhance the governance and service delivery capacity and efficiency of LGUs, maintenance and operating costs of fire stations, fire trucks, jail buildings, prisoner vans, police stations, police vehicles, and police patrol operations, provision of subsistence and medicine allowance for the projected 182,556 persons deprived of liberty, quick response fund for the Philippine National Police and the Bureau of Fire Protection, and rice subsidy for the uniformed personnel of the Tribe Bureau. Our capital outlays will be a construction of 60 fire stations, one district jail and perimeter fences in four district jails, and 11 police stations, procurement of 41 fire trucks, 6 ambulances, 3 collapse rescue trucks, 14 BGMP transport vehicles for 61 patrol jeeps and 120 personnel carriers, acquisition of firearms and communication and investigative equipment, as well as procurement of various furniture and fixtures. We shall also be providing highlights of the DILG's budget per agency. For the Office of the Secretary, the fiscal year 2023 budget will be used to continuously promote good governance and to enhance LU capacities for them to effectively perform services devolved to them per the Local Government Code of 1991 and as reiterated in the Supreme Court ruling on the Mandanas-Garcia petitions, particularly on the following: measuring LU performance and provision of awards and incentives through the seal of good local governance, enhancing CSO and citizen participation, capacitating LGUs for improved LGU competitiveness and ease of doing business, which includes digitalization of LGU processes for swifter and more efficient service delivery, heightening accountability through fact-finding and case build-up against erring local officials, advocating for decentralization and constitutional reforms, monitoring and evaluation of LGU infrastructure projects, which is important to ensure project implementation by LGU and meant for the people, are delivered accordingly and on time. We will also bolster our peace and order initiatives through the following: our intensified fight against illegal drugs, violent extremism, and insurgency to bring about peace and development in communities, continuous strengthening of local institutions for peace to work in partnership with the PNP and peace-promoting groups as a way of improving opportunities for development in LGUs, and the continuous operations of the 911 emergency services to ensure swift government response to emergency and distress calls by the general public. As the agency mandated by law to be the vice chair for disaster preparedness, our initiatives for environmental protection and disaster resiliency will be continued and scaled up, cognizant of the fact that disasters and their unprecedented frequency and magnitude stall governance and development and bring hardship to people. The Local Government Academy will continue to be the department's training arm, which will provide key and relevant capacity enhancement initiatives to LGUs and DILG personnel through the following: enhancement of LGUs capacities in disaster risk reduction and climate change adaptation through our Operation LISTO, capacity development for newly elected officials for peace building in peace challenged communities and LGUs, intensified operations of DILG School of Local Governance, continuous provision of awards to deserving officials and units of the department and allied organizations, and the continuous initiatives for research studies, policy formulation, and monitoring and evaluation. The Philippine National Police will continue pursuing its mandate to serve and protect the Filipino people by increasing its manpower capacity through the hiring of 1,000 men and women, which is expected to improve further the police-to-population ratio to 1:494. Construction of 11 police stations to increase the fill-up rate to 68%, procurement of police vehicles, firearms, communications, and other equipment to improve PNP's move-shoot-communicate capability, and the provision of quick response fund that will ensure fast and reliable police response and mobility during disasters and calamities. For the Bureau of Fire Protection, hiring of additional 2,000 fire officers, which will improve both the fill-up rate to 63% and the fire officer to population ratio to 1:3,161. Construction of 60 fire stations, which will increase the fill-up rate to 90%, thereby reducing the number of municipalities without fire stations. Procurement of 41 fire trucks that will improve the fill-up rate to 71%. And the provision of quick response fund and procurement of disaster risk reduction equipment to increase BFP's rescue and response capability. The Bureau of Jail Management and Penology will improve the safekeeping of persons deprived of liberties through the following: hiring of additional 2,000 jail officers, bringing the fill-up rate to 42.58%, construction of one district jail in Kabadbaran City that will increase the number of jails that are not congested from 140 to 141, construction of perimeter fences in four jails to strengthen jail security and prevent escape incidents, procurement of transport vehicles, firearms, and communication equipment to improve the current fill-up rates, provision of subsistence and medicine allowances to the projected 182,556 PDLs, and the implementation of integrated jail management information system for the digitalization of BJMP operations. For the National Police Commission, the budget will be for the payment of police benefits, speedy resolution of administrative cases involving policemen, as well as the PS requirements of newly filled positions. It will also spearhead strong community police relations critical to preventing and addressing peace and order challenges on the ground. The Philippine Public Safety College shall pursue the professionalization of uniformed personnel through the following: cadetship program for 200 fire and jail cadets, conduct of the educational courses with 445 participants, and the mandatory training courses with 10,850 participants, implementation of the master education and training program with 9,775 participants, as well as the continuous improvement in the quality of education and training through research and development, extension, curriculum enhancement, faculty development, and monitoring and evaluation. The Philippine Commission on Women will continue to work for women empowerment through, among others, ensuring the gender responsiveness of government policies, plans, and programs. And through the PCW's efforts, we are optimistic that gender-based violence will decline and respect for women and children's rights will improve. The National Commission on Muslim Filipinos, on the other hand, will continue the implementation of socio-cultural, economic, and social protection programs to address the needs and concerns of our brother Muslim Filipinos. The National Youth Commission will focus its sights on the continued support and capacity development interventions of the Sangguniang Kabataan and youth organizations in the country, so they will become active partners in addressing the needs of the Filipino youth. The honorable members of the committee, that concludes the presentation of the DILG budget. Maraming salamat po at magandang umaga sa ating lahat.
So, we've heard already the presentation of the Department of Interior and Local Government. Now, we have with us the list of those of congressmen or representatives who will be asking questions or to interpolate the DILG. And at this point in time, may I remind our distinguished colleagues that each member is given 5 minutes for questioning or interpolation. That is excluding the response of the resource persons. And when you hear the bell sound, it means you only have 30 seconds to wind up with your questions. And as part of a long-standing and respected tradition of the House of Representatives to accord preferential treatment for the minority members of the House and followed by the majority members in an alternating manner. So at this point in time, the chair recognizes from the minority, the Honorable Minority Floor Leader, Honorable Marcelino Libanon. In the absence of the minority floor leader, may the chair now recognize the deputy minority leader Mujib Ataman.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Magandang umaga po. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Alam nyo, dito sa Kongreso, merong tradisyon. Kaya nakatapat ho natin si Ben Hur. Si SILG na dati hong miyembro yan ng Kamara noong 13 Congress. Pero mahirap lang sek na hindi ho maklarify yung mga ilang katanungan kahit meron kaming accord ng courtesy ho sa inyo bilang dating kasama dito sa Kongreso. Lalo't lalo ho on my part dahil dito sa mga bagong pangyayari sa loob ng Bangsamoro Autonomous Region at pinanood ko nga ho mismo yung press conference ni General Azurin kahapon. At tiningnan ko rin yung mga reactions ng ilang mga kababayan natin. Lalo't pa, unang araw ito nung Peace Month. At merong pangyayari nung ilang araw. Pero bago ang lahat at bago ako magsimula, General Azurin, nais kong ipaabot ang aking pagdadalamhati at pakikiramay sa buong pambansang pulisya sa pagpanaw ng inyong miyembro, si Colonel Samson. At lalong-lalo ho, ang aking pakikiramay sa pamilyang mga naiwan ni Colonel Samson. But anyway, in connection ho, doon sa pangyayaring yon, gusto ko lang malaman ho, based doon sa press conference ni General Azurin, kung ano talaga ang tunay na pangyayari. Ang warrant of arrest ba ay isi-serve ito sa BIFF, sa miyembro ng MILF or MNLF, or sa miyembro ng extremist group or sa mga ordinaryong kriminal sa loob ng munisipyo ng Ampatuan?
Thank you very much, Madam Chairman, sir. Sir, yun pong operation po ng ating dating hepe po ng Ampatuan Municipal Police Station, he was there to serve the warrant of arrest po, sir, for robbery with violence or intimidation of a person, sir. Warrant of arrest po ito, sir, against kay Kamir Kambal alias Meds po, sir. Isa po siyang miyembro ng BIFF, Mr. Chairman, sir.
Sir, napanood ko sa inyong interview sa palasyo nung kahapon ho. Binabanggit niyo, parang sinasabi, ewan ko kung merong nagtanong na media ho sa inyo, pero parang ang sinasabi niyo, bakit kailangan naming mag-coordinate at bakit kailangan namin magpaalam sa MILF, which is tama po kayo. Pero ang tanong ko rito, meron kasing mechanism ang peace process, ang alam ko, yung tinatawag nilang AJAG, of which na merong miyembro from PNP. Kung hindi ako nagkakamali, dapat nasa level ng full-fledged colonel or na general. Kasi nung panahon ko, nung armed government, armed governor, umupo po ako sa mechanism na yan paminsan-minsan at tumutulong dahil ayaw nating mangyari yung nangyari nung panahon ng Mama Sapano. No, kaya in-strengthen yung AJAG na yan. Ang tanong ko lang, activated pa ba ang AJAG? Kaya hindi, kumbaga hindi properly coordinated yung pag-serve ng warrant of arrest doon sa area ng Ampatuan. Unang tanong. Pangalawang tanong, itong area ba ng Ampatuan ay declared na area ng Moro Islamic Liberation Front?
Yes po, sir. Activated pa po yung AJAG, sir. And at the same time, sir, the area, sir, na kung saan po isa-serve yung warrant of arrest ng wanted person is apparently, it's one of the MILF campo na nabanggit po, sir. Ang ginagawa lang po ng ating kapulisan doon ay they're just on a law enforcement function po, sir. They were in uniform. They were on board a mobile patrol po, sir. So kung ang sinasabi po nila na hindi po nag-coordinate po, sir, is very visible naman po na yung mga pumapasok po sa area na yon ay uniformed PNP personnel serving a legitimate po, sir, na warrant of arrest issued by a competent court po, sir.
Ito, nabasa ko lang, General Azurin, no, i-ano ko na lang to, mamaya sa budget ako pupunta in detail. Kaya ako nga ho tinatanong ito dahil merong mechanism. Kaya kanina gusto kong malaman kung meron pa bang nakaupo mula sa Philippine National Police sa Ad Hoc Committee on Joint Action Group or sa AJAG.
Meron pa po, Mr. Chairman, sir.
So nung panahon na yon, ibig sabihin, no, walang hindi aware yung MILF sa area through AJAG na meron kayong operation laban sa, I mean to serve warrant against the BIFF members. Are they aware or not? Yung AJAG, ang sinasabi ko yung AJAG.
I think they are not aware po, sir, na ano, yung coordination na sinasabi po nila ay hindi po nangyari, sir, but again, sir, this law enforcement function po, sir, na kung saan po, sir, ay very identified naman po, verifiable naman po na the one who are about to implement po yung warrant of arrest are legitimate po na mga PNP personnel po, sir.
Anyway, so parang sinasabi nyo ngayon, hindi nyo kailangan mag-coordinate dahil law enforcement ito?
Ganun na nga po, sir, because there is only one PNP na ang function po, sir, ay anywhere in the Philippines po, sir. And ito po, sir, ay pagsisilbi po, sir, ng, or pag-implement para ma-aresto po ang mga wanted person, sir, because meron naman po kaming hawak-hawak na warrant of arrest po, sir. And yun pong sinasabi po, sir, na we need to coordinate po sa ano, sa identified na MILF camp po. Sir, I had been assigned po in same place po when I was a lieutenant, sir. At alam ko po, sir, na pag ikaw po ay magko-coordinate, yung probability po, sir, na magne-negative po yung yung trabaho ay napakalaki po, sir.
And anggit ko nga lang yung General Azurin kasi merong mechanism, yung AJAG nga. Parang, in fact, ni-review ko lang ngayon, nung 2013 to in-enhance. In fact, after Mama Sapanu, in-enhance din yung mechanism na to. Parang ang purpose nito para hindi mangyari yung mga, kumbaga, miscommunication doon law sa law enforcement. And in fact, siguro pagdating din ng budget ng OPAP, isa rin to sa mga itatanong namin, kung ano yung arrangement. Kasi pwedeng dalawang arrangement, halimbawa, yung AJAG mechanism, pangalawa, merong political structure which is under the leadership dominated by MILF, yung BARM government. And in fact, sa provision ng Bangsamoro Organic Law, sinasabi ho doon, walang pwedeng ma-assign na pro-BAR regional director ng BARM na kung walang coordination sa chief minister. So ibig sabihin, andon yung dalawang structure. Kaya ako ho, medyo nangamba lang ako na nangyari yung ganito. Dahil ang nakakatakot ho dyan, baka lumala yung situation dahil lang sa mga miscommunication, baka kailangan ma-review natin with OPAP yung joint circular na pinimbahan ng Philippine government through AJAG, kung paano yung operationalization nito, of which andyan yung Philippine National Police na nakaupo mismo dyan sa AJAG na yan. Kaya medyo yung
may
point ko na sinasabi nyo na bakit kailangan naming magpaalam.
Congressman, that you only have like
tama ho kayo
seconds.
Doon na hindi kayo dapat magpaalam kasi nga ho merong mechanism. Pero ang kaya ang tinanong ko kanina, kung ang mechanism na ba to ay hindi na ho aktibo, so ang tingin ko para matanong natin yung peace process mechanism kung bakit nangyari yung mga ganitong sitwasyon.
Okay, so thank you. May we get an answer from the DILG?
Magandang,
yeah. Congressman Hataman, okay. if you still be asking more about, okay, so we list you in the second round. Okay, so may we get a response?
Yes,
from,
ma'am.
From the DILG.
Well, kahapon po ay nakausap ko sa Secretary Charlie Galvez of the OPAP. Yes, and I raised these issues para tama po kayo. Para once and for all, masettle po natin ang proseso, lahat po para walang miscommunication. The gripes of the police are valid. We only have one Philippine National Police. And of course, andyan ang BARM. Dapat magkatulungan tayo talaga rito. Yung mga konting gaps na ito ay dapat mapag-usapan kaagad. No? So I'm arranging a meeting right now with the counterpart, si Minister Naguib of the BARM about this. Wag ko kayong mag-alala, but what is important is we have one purpose. In fact, tumawag po ako sa BARM at they will help us. Magtutulungan po ang PNP, ang AFP, ang BARM para mahuli po ang mga gumawa nitong atrocities na ito. Salamat po.
Okay, so may we get an update? Maybe the Honorable Hataman would like to be given an update on this particular issue. Honorable. Okay. So may you please give an update to the Committee on Appropriation, Secretary Abalos?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So we can furnish, the committee can furnish a copy to the Deputy Minority Leader, Hataman. I would like to remind our colleagues here that in front you can see the time so that you will be updated as to how more minutes left for you to ask or interpellate our family of the ILG. So the next to be recognize is the Deputy Majority Leader, the Honorable Franz Pumarin.
Thank you very much, Madam Presiding Officer, for reminding us na may nandun po yung time. So parang nasa Araneta lang po tayo, nagbabasketball, may time limit, kung alam na natin shoot. Anyway, good morning. Follow up ko lang po yung sinasabi po ni Congressman Mujib. Ano ba talagang dapat susundin natin? Yung MILF agreement, yung sa BARM agreement, para hindi po nagkakaroon ng ganyan problema. Coming from Metro Manila, Congressman, para at least naman magkaroon kami ng idea talaga.
Thank you very much, Your Honor, sir. I think, sir, after the agreement, nagkaroon na po tayo ng pirma ng peace process po natin, sir. I think it's very important po na ang susundin na po natin, sir, ay yung patakaran po ng current na gobyerno, sir. Sinasabi ko nga po, sir, is the mandate of the Philippine National Police, sir, is to enforce, sir, lahat po ng batas sa buong Pilipinas, sir. Hindi po niya sinasabi, sir, na except. So, on the part, sir, ng ating mga kasamahan po sa BARM, since they have embraced po itong peace process na ito, sir, sana, sir, ay makitaan din po natin sila ng sinceridad because itong mga in-implement po natin, sir, na mga warrant of arrest, these are so many years na na-issue na po nung wala pa pong peace process. Kaya ang pinakamaganda po siguro dito ay tignan po nila yung mga miyembro nila o hanay po nila dun sa nabanggit na mga MILF camp. And then, voluntary po sana na isurrender na lang po nila itong mga ito para na sa ganun ay hindi po tayo nagkakaroon ng problema na kailangan mo pang magpaalam. So, on their part po siguro, sir, ay magkaroon po tayo ng parang cleansing among our ranks. Sino po ba yung mga may existing na warrant of arrest sa mga miyembro natin so that i-give up na po natin sila. And then, they start to negotiate with the government. Ano po ba ang pwede nating gawin? Bigyan ba natin po sila ng amnesty? Hindi po yung ganun na ang kapulisan po natin ay mag-i-implement lamang po ng arrest, ng issued warrant of arrest. And yet, ito nga po ang nangyari na medyo namatayan po kami, Your Honor.
Thank you very much, no. Anyway, yung looking at your budget, yung sa local government support fund, medyo may 61% increase yung 2023 proposal, which is a total of 10.9 billion. Now, with the advent of yung Mandanas-Garcia ruling, yung LGU is getting a big chunk of already sa national allotment, national tax allotment. Alam naman po natin yung increase ng budget ng local government unit, don't you think na dapat decreasing na po yung ano natin, local government support fund instead of increasing?
Okay. Ito pong kasing Mandanas ruling na ito, no? Medyo malaki po talaga ang implication sa lahat, no? On the part of the national and the local. Ang pinaka-apektado po talaga rito will be the 4th, 5th, and 6th class. Kaya po mayroong talagang ginawang support fund for them. Sa ngayon ay masasabi natin there's a windfall. No? However, since last year, nagpalabas po ang DBM na in accordance with the devolution, all the repairs and construction of school buildings, bahala na po ang LGU. Hindi lang yun, I think it's communal irrigation at marami pang iba. Naglabas po ang DBM nito. Medyo sa iba, kaya at iba ho talaga hindi kakayanin. There are some rich cities, but mind you, if you look at the 4th, 5th, and 6th class, 5th and 6th class make up about 19% of all municipalities. If you include the 4th class, that's about 45% of all municipalities. Siguro on the issue of construction and even repair of school buildings, baka hindi po nila kayanin. Yun po nakukuha namin feedback at sa amin po mga pakikipag-coordinate sa kanila po. No? Dire-diretso po ito. Ang malaking problema po natin dito is that since hindi nila kakayanin ito, Congressman, siguro i-identify namin na dito namin kukunin. Pero may darating na bagyo. Ano yun? By next year, ang kanilang ERA ay mababawasan because the basis of the ERA will be the previous year. And the previous year was pandemic. No? Mm-hmm. So, mababawasan po sila ng about 14% decrease. So, yan po ang kinaharap ngayon ng mga local government units. That is why itong sinasabing local government support fund, no, it will not... Yeah, at hindi ho ito i-release sa amin ha, sa DILG. Direkta po ito sa mga LGU na i-identify po. At more particularly, ito yung siguro more or less yung talagang maihirap na LGU. Kami gusto kang idagdag.
Thank you very much, sir. And once again, good morning to the members of the committee. The LGSF, sir, is divided into four. We have the financial assistance to local government units. We have the growth equity fund.
Sir, pwedeng pakilakas lang. Thank
yes,
you.
Yes, maraming salamat, sir. Yeah. The LGSF is divided into four. Growth equity fund, financial assistance to local government units. The third is the support to barangay development program. And that's for 2023, there are three components of the LGSF. For 2022, there are four, but for 2023, sir, there are three.
Madam Presiding Officer, thank you very much. No, kagaya po ng mention ni Secretary, ang mangyayari po is yung mga medyo hindi mga third, second, but third class municipalities, sila po ang magre-request yung in terms of yung funding sa specific area sila, kagaya ng school buildings and everything. So paano po magiging proseso natin based on the request or the observation of the DILG with regards to local support fund? Kasi Mr. Secretary, di ba minention nyo nga, part ng magiging programa dito yung sa mga school buildings. So ang question ko lang po dito, paano po magiging proseso natin kung sino unang bababaan natin ng tulong? Upon request ba o upon recommendation po ng inyong ahensya?
Your Honor, Madam Chair, the support to barangay development program, which is a component of the LGSF, no, amounting to 10 billion pesos, we have already pre-identified the barangays, 959 of them for 2023. And these barangays are the barangays that were cleared of the communist terrorist groups. It went through the process of identification, plus the process of long-listing the development needs of the barangays. And this will be funded through the 10 billion support to barangay development program. The other one is the financial assistance to local government units, which is actually technically being administered by the Department of Budget and Management. The request of LGUs will be submitted directly to DBM. It will be the DBM which will determine which among these LGUs will receive the financial assistance. And the growth equity fund will be determined. The LGUs that will benefit from the growth equity fund will be determined through a criteria that will be set by the Development Budget Coordinating Committee. The criteria are the following. The first filter is the income class of the local government unit. Particularly, focus will be given to the 4th, 5th, and 6th class municipalities. The second filter will be poverty incidence and national tax allocation per capita. Per capita national tax allocation. Those are the criteria for the GEF, Your Honor.
Madam Presiding Officer, if I may, again. Yung sa last year natin, ano ba na pa-implement po natin na projects with regards dito sa support? Dahil you're asking for a 61% increase. Eh. Na-maximize po ba natin lahat?
Last year, Your Honor, for the support to barangay development program, the menu was contained in the General Appropriations Act. And the projects that can be funded from the SBDP fund are farm-to-market roads, school buildings, health centers, potable water system, electrification, livelihood program, and financial assistance to indigent individuals and families. That's for the SBDP. For the LGSF FALGU, the fund can be used for purchase of ambulances, trucks, mini dump trucks, purchase of medical rescue and disaster related equipment, street lighting for barangay electrification, purchase and installation of closed circuit television surveillance system, and assistance to indigent families. For 2022, we have a CMGP, a conditional matching grant to provinces, which shall be used to improve or for the construction of provincial roads. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you very much. Question lang po kay Sec. Ang normal procedure ba when magkakaroon po ng reshuffle sa kapulisan sa bawat syudad, do we need to inform the local executive chief?
Well, when I was mayor, basta merong bibigyan po kami ng list at mamimili kami. Mm-hmm. Pero kung merong OIC, kuminsan bigla na lang pong nag-reshuffle at merong OIC. But as a practice, and this is what we intend to do, the chief executive will be given a list kung sino pong gusto niyang ilalagay po.
Okay, thank you very much. Because nitong recent na bago magkaroon ng reshuffle, I was with Mayor Joy. Nagulat na lang kami when we got the notice na magkakaroon po ng reshuffle. Then Mayor was telling me nga she was not notified nung yung reshuffle na yun eh. But of course, na-correct po natin yun. I just want to to make it clear kung ano po talaga, kung nagbago ba ang procedure natin and everything.
Yes, sir. Actually, hindi lang sa Quezon City, pero halos sa lahat. No? And Chief Azurin had this reshuffle. But one thing I could assure everyone is that each and every chief executive will choose from among the list as has been done before. Yun po ang tradisyon talaga. And we will abide by that, sir.
So thank you, Sec. So what you're saying, it's an assurance if ever there's going to be, shuffle ulit or reshuffling ng mga district director in every LGUs, yung chief executive will be given notice.
Yes, sir.
And parang may choices. Tama po ba?
Tama po kayo.
Okay.
And, sir, yung question lang, if I will just add about the growth equity fund, ito equalizer.
Yes, thank you.
Ang tatlo pong criteria, no, of course, sinabi niya na yung filter, especially 4th, 5th, and 6th class, poverty incidence, and yung per capita. And so lumalabas dito sa probinsya, tatlo eligible. Sa cities, 7. Sa municipalities is 150. No? Yung po yung lista namin at sa barangays ay 270. Ito po talaga may criteria para makita na walang palakasan. No? There are tables po rito. No? So base po rito, ito yung tinututukan naming baka maapektuhan po ng husto. That's why there is this fund para matulungan po sila. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Madam Presiding Officer.
Okay. Thank you very much, Deputy Authority Leader Franz Pumarin. I would like to inform our colleagues and everyone that data agencies under the Department of Interior and Local Government are 10. We have 10, right, Secretary? There are 10 attached agencies. And one of those attached agencies is the National Youth Commission. I would like to inform the body that the vice chair in charge of the National Youth Commission is the Honorable Vice Chair Carl Nicolas Curry. He's with us now. So next to interpolate is the Honorable Representative Raul Manuel of the Kabataan Party List.
Good morning, Madam Chair. Good morning sa ating mga panauhin mula sa Department of Interior and Local Government. Yung una ko pong tanong ay i-address ko sa National Youth Commission. Naglabas ng posisyon ang NYC na sinusuportahan nito ang pagbabalik ng mandatory ROTC. Gusto ko munang malaman kung alam ba ng NYC kung bakit ginawang optional yung ganitong programa way back in 2001.
Madam Chair, Yusek Cardema po, Chairman ng NYC. Yes, in 2001, it was scrapped by Congress because of the killing of Mark Wilson Chua in UST, sir.
Okay. Now, since familiar naman yung NYC dun sa naging history ng ganong programa, inaasahan natin na mas magiging prudent ito no, dun sa pag-issue niya ng kanyang mga official stances. Lalo na recently, marami tayong nakikita ang mga ginagawa ng leadership na NYC na hindi aligned sa kanyang mandato. For example, yung pagkakonduct ng mga counterinsurgency orientation sa hanay ng mga sangguniang kabataan. Although may sagot na dito dati, yung NYC, ang banggit ay naganap ito noong 2021 at hindi pa naman ulit NYC chair si Mr. Ronald Cardema. So ang tingin po ba ng NYC, may maling nangyari pero hindi involved si Ronald Cardema?
Mr. Chair, I was appointed chairman this 2022, January 17 by President Duterte for a term of 3 years. And regarding the issue of NYC being part of the NTF-LCAC, I think it is only proper, sir, because the NPA is mainly recruiting the youth to replenish its ranks. Therefore, it should be the NYC should be very active in preventing the youth to be recruited, sir. And that is why we are active in the NTF-LCAC, sir.
Yeah. Now, Madam Chair, kahit hindi pa man NYC chairperson si Mr. Ronald Cardema nung panahon na yon, pero siya na ay na-appoint bilang commissioner kasi since August 2020 ay naibalik na siya sa National Youth Commission. Kaya nakakapagtaka para sa atin kung ano ba talaga yung primary mandate ng NYC kasi ngayon it acts like an extension of counterinsurgency efforts kaysa tumugon sa pangangailangan ng mga kabataan. Nung pandemic, primary problems natin, education, paano magkakaroon ng trabaho yung mga kabataan. At para makonduct yung mga training na yon, ang ginamit ay pondo for SK sana kung paano sila gumana bilang mga opisyal ng ating pamahalaan. Pati yung pondo for Task Force Bangon Marawi. And actually, hindi ito yung bago eh. Medyo recurring na yung ganitong paggastos ng NYC sa kanyang mga pondo. Quick recap lang para maintindihan po na ating kapulungan yung gravity nito. 2018 ay meron ng sobra-sobra mga bayad for time off, special day off, leave credit, sobrang reimbursement sa mga seminar, travel and meals. Tapos, 2019 naman, overspending sa mga proyekto. 90% of project funds ginamit for just 4 out of 12 projected activities. 2020 naman, 8.9 million para sa mga contractual workers. Kahit na yung trabaho ay kaya nang gawin ng mga regular workers. Tapos for 2021, ganito. Kaya naman, Madam Chair, ganito yung nangyayari habang kulang yung pondong inilalaan para sa ating mga SK. Kahit na masisipag sila, alam nila yung kanilang mandato at hangga't nila yung financial autonomy pero hindi sila ng pagbibigyan. Napu-pull down din yung efforts ng mga employees mismo ng NYC. Kaya I'd like to address this to the leadership of DILG na i-consider yung pagpapalit ng leadership ng NYC. Sana masusi itong mapag-aralan kasi matagal na itong hinaing ng maraming youth organizations. Next, Madam Chair, tungkol naman sa ating kapulisan, to the Philippine National Police. I'd like to inquire anong units ng PNP yung in charge sa mga social media posts.
Okay, may we get a response from, may we get an answer from the PNP chief maybe?
Sir, ang in charge po sa social media posts namin, sir, ay yun aming pong Directorate for Police and Community Relations po, sir.
Okay. How about yung mga local units ng PNP? May similar unit din ba in charge sa kanilang social media?
Yes, sir. Yun pong mga R5s po namin, sila rin po ang in charge sa mga posting sa mga social media, sir.
Yes. Kasi may mga ilang pages ng PNP na na-observe natin na patuloy pa din ng red tag. Kahit na ang sabi na ng ating National Security Advisor, wala nang red tagging. So I'm confused kung nagsisinungaling ba or paasa si ating NSA Advisor on red tagging or hindi sumusunod yung PNP na dapat wala nang red tagging. So alin ba yung case dito?
We'll check on that, sir, kasi may mga specific policy guidelines naman po tayo and will be investigating po kung sino po yung mga units na allegedly na nag re-red tagging po.
Mm-hmm. Kasi hindi lang siya alleged incident. For example, nung Ninoy Aquino Day mismo, meron tayong documentation na mismo si Ninoy Aquino ay nire-red tag ng ating kapulisan. No? Hindi lamang ito disinformation, pero it contributes to historical distortion sa ating bansa. So, nagbanggit na rin dati na mag-investigate. Meron pa bang update tungkol dito?
Yes, sir. I will be submitting po yung action taken po namin dyan dun sa posting nung Ninoy Aquino Day po.
Okay. And finally, noong June 9, 2022, after the national elections, merong memorandum yung PNP, particularly yung Navotas City Police Station, na ang directive ay i-profile lahat ng area kung saan ay merong botong nakuha yung party lists ng Makabayan Coalition, and that includes Kabataan.
Yeah, will may I gently remind to the this kind of Honorable Manuel that you only have 10 seconds left?
Okay. Yes, Madam Chair. This would be the final question.
Thank you.
Is the PNP willing to revoke this memorandum that infringes on the right of people to freely choose kung sino yung kanilang iboboto during elections without fear na sila ibabalikan?
We'll check on that memo, sir, and we'll give you our actions taken.
That would be all, Madam Chair.
Now, if you have more questions to ask Honorable Manuel, then you can be listed in the second round. So, may the Chair now recognize the Honorable Representative Rosana Vergara.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'd also like to thank Kong Palma for allowing me to take his place. Good morning, Secretary Abalos, and to the DILG family. My question, Madam Chair, is for COP Azurin. The appointment of the COP should follow RA 8551, Section 51 of Republic Act Number 6975, where the mayors are given at least the freedom to choose from a short list of 5 nominees. But in my district, and I assume all over the country, this is no longer being followed. In Cabanatuan City po, in 4 years, we've had 7 chief of police, and the continuity and the lack of familiarity as they're getting to know lang the city or the municipality, papalitan na. My question, COP Azurin, this is a deviation from what the law requires. Will we be continuing this practice? And if so, why are we not following the law?
Okay, may we get a response from
thank you very much, Your Honor. Yun pong pag-assign po namin ng mga chief of police specifically po pagdating po sa mga municipal police stations at saka city police stations. Ito po, ma'am, ay ang nag-assign po dyan are the provincial directors or the regional directors po. And ang assignment po nila usually is officer in charge because we have to process po. We have to process po, sir, ma'am, yung mga other qualified chief of police, and then we'll be furnishing the local chief executive. In the case po of city police stations, we submit 5 names for the local chief executive to choose. And in the case of municipal police stations, we submit 3 names for them to choose po. Ganun din po ang proseso po natin sa city directors, sa provincial directors, at saka sa mga chief of police po ng National Capital Regional Police Office, ma'am. So rest assured po, ma'am, na yun pong seating na chief of police po ninyo, darating po, ma'am, yung recommendation po namin na 5 pangalan na kung saan po ay pagpipilian po ninyo.
So, sir, I have your assurance that we will go back to the way it should be because the last 6 years po, hindi nasunod. And I'm hoping that under this new administration, we will go back to the way it should be where the municipal mayor, I understand, yes, the OIC, but then what happens is hindi dumadating yung listahan, so yung OIC nagiging permanente na. Kahapon lamang po, gagawin na naman sana po sa kabanatuan, pero sabi ko, tatanungin ko po na susunod na po tayo sa batas. Tama po?
Yes, ma'am. There are cases po kasi, ma'am, na due to the exigency po kuminsan ng service, we have to place an OIC po. So, but we still follow naman po yung ano, after the vetting, after the processing po, we submit po yung ano, yung five names in the case of the city police station like Cabanatuan City po, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Congressman, if I might add.
Yes, Mr. Secretary.
I've been a mayor before, and that has always been the tradition, and that is the law. And we intend to follow the law. If there's anyone, any mayor, for that matter, for the municipal, local level, or even the provincial level, just let me know. I've already ordered our chief PNP to abide by the law, that this procedure should really be followed. If not, please feel free, just inform me, ASA. Thank you.
Thank you for the reassurance, Secretary Ablos. Thank you, COP Azurin. That's all, Madam Chair.
Okay. Thank you, Congressman Vergara. The next to be recognized is Senior Deputy Minority Leader Paul Daza. So, in the absence of our Senior Deputy Minority Leader, okay, may the chair now recognize the Honorable Deputy Minority Leader Franz Castro.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Magandang umaga po sa ating mga panauhin at sa lahat po. Una, Madam Chair, yung tungkol po doon sa 2021 COA reports or observations, COA noted that 103 billion or 97% billion NTFL CAC fund under the PNP budget was dispersed to pay for various procurements and balance of 32 million as of December 2021. Pwede bang malaman, Madam Chair, ano itong mga na-procure out of 1.03 billion fund?
Okay, maybe get an answer from the DILG.
The PNP is just checking on the records, ma'am, in regards to this COA report.
Madam Chair, in the interest of time, can
yes.
we just have it submitted to the committee? In preparation for my subsequent interpellation in the plenary session.
Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
So maybe ask the DILG to provide a copy to the Committee on Appropriations.
Yes,
so that,
Madam Chair.
We can furnish a copy to the Honorable yes. Representative Franz Castro.
The PNP will do it. Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, under the NEP 2023, saan naman kaya, Madam Chair, balak gamitin itong 1.084 billion na nasa MOOE budget.
If we get a response from
Ma'am, Your Honor po, doon po sa 1.084 billion budget ng ating pong LCAC, it will be spent po dun sa 12 clusters po sa na kung saan po ay kasama po ang PNP, ma'am. Like for example, the yung 12 clusters po ng ating LCAC initiative is the peace, yung pledge cluster po, yung strategic communication cluster, yung situational awareness and knowledge management cluster, sectoral unification capacity building, empowerment and mobilization cluster, International Engagement Cluster, the ECLIP and Amnesty Program Cluster, the Legal Cooperation, the Local Government Empowerment Cluster, the Local Peace Engagement Cluster, the Basic Services Cluster, the Livelihood, Poverty Reduction, Employment, and Infrastructure and Resource Cluster. We will provide you po, ma'am, yung breakdown po ng 1,084,000 for next year's budget po, ma'am.
Okay, thank you, Madam Chair. Asahan natin ito, no, yung breakdown ng projects nitong 1.084 billion MOOE. Pag sinabi man nating equipment, capital outlay na nasa GAA 2021, kasi nung tinignan, Madam Chair, tinignan po yung GAA 2021, nasa MOOE ang budget ng PNP for NTF-LCAC. Bakit nyo ito ginamit for procurement? Kapag sinabi ba nating equipment or capital outlay, pati ba NEP sa 2023, kahit na MOOE budget ang pinopropose nyo, gagamitin nyo rin pala sa capital outlay. So bakit ganito, Madam Chair?
May we get a response from the GPNP?
I think, ma'am, we are not allowed to convert from capital outlay to MOE. So the MOE portion should be spent really for MOE po, ma'am.
So can you please provide the Honorable Franz Castro a copy of those already been utilized under this particular appropriation?
Yes,
because
Your Honor.
I know that a certain office or department, even in the local government unit, they cannot spend without appropriation coming from the Sanggunian. Now, in the national budget, without an appropriation or authorization coming from Congress. Otherwise, yes, that's a juggling of funds.
Yes,
so, in other words, Honorable Franz Castro, I think they're following the law.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Kasi nakakalito po, ano, nasa equipment pero ginamit sa capital outlay pero nasa MOOE budget.
No, because if it's capital outlay, I believe ito yung mga equipment sa kong Representative Castro. If we
yes,
say capital outlay, ganun yun yata eh, because I had also been a local chief executive kaya.
Yeah. Just have a report, ano, at saka yung budget ng PNP sa 2020 to 2022 on LCAC, kung saan ginamit at ano-ano yung mga binili at ano yung status at magkano, Madam Chair.
Yes, Your Honor, will provide po.
Okay. Kindly provide the Chief PNP the Committee on Appropriation so that we can furnish a copy to the Honorable Franz Castro.
Yes,
thank you,
Madam Chairman, sir.
To move on, Madam Chair, how about the body camera implementation? Can we have an update on the implementation of the rules on the use of body-worn cameras in the execution of warrants, which was issued by the Supreme Court last June 2029? Ano po nangyari, Madam Chair, doon sa 334 million budget na procurement daw ng body cameras na na-appropriate siya 2018 pa? Ilang body cameras ang nabili at nagamit ng pulis? Ilan pa ang kailangan at saan nakalagay yung budget para dito, Madam Chair? Kasi Madam Chair, recently, di ba, ewan ko lang kung nakagamit ng body camera itong si yung sa Maguindanao na na-ambush at napatay doon sa lugar ng Ampatuan, etong si Reynaldo Samson na chief dito sa Maguindanao. Dati siya kasing teacher, pero naka-ward ba siya ng camera at that time nung napatay siya? Kasi magsaserve siya ng warrant eh. So, can we have an investigation on this?
Yes, ma'am. That's part of our inquiry or investigations that are being conducted by our PNP. Doon kung nakagamit po siya ng ano ng body worn camera, because while it is true that we were able to purchase almost 3,000 units of body worn camera, ito po, ma'am, ay hindi po sapat po for distribution po sa iba't ibang unit namin. That's why we prioritize po yung distribution ng mga body worn camera namin sa mga component city stations, sa mga city police offices. So we have to check po kung ang Maguindanao po, specifically ang Ampatuan Municipal Police Station, are recipient of the body-worn camera. That's why we really need additional funds for the procurement of a body-worn camera para lahat po ng ating mga operating units will be able to be issued so that pag nagkandak po sila ng police operation, ay sigurado po na may magagamit po sila.
Okay. So inasmuch as you will be needing more body cams, because I remember that in the previous funds were allocated for the purchase of body cams. Now, is it a part of, is it included in your 2023 budget, Secretary? The purchase of body cam. Is it a part of your capital outlay, particularly in the budget of PNP?
No, ma'am. That's why that is one of the requests that we'll be asking Congress, ma'am, if they can allocate additional budget for the purchase of body-worn camera po.
Okay, that's noted.
Kailangan ko lang, Madam Chair, yung report, no, kung ilan yung mga nabili, tsaka na-procure. About BJMP naman, Madam Chair, may I know the total number of recorded deaths in 2020-2021 to the present in the BJMP jails? And ano ba yung causes ng death? At saka saan yung jail? Saan jails, Madam Chair? What is the percent of COVID cases? Kasi, Madam Chair, in recent years, 300 to 800 detainees have died in BJMP annually. Our figures are still the same despite the ano no, yung nakita natin. At ang tanong ko lang po, ang figure po ba ay tama na more than 300 to 800 detainees have died sa BJMP annually?
Mr. Chair, Bill Director Alan Aran. Your Honors, first for the COVID updates, we have 5,041 confirmed cases for PDL, and of this number, 4,915 recovered already, and 54 succumbed to the disease, Your Honor. So 1.0%. Of the total 5,041 cases of PDL na nagkaroon ng COVID ay namatay. And with respect to the data on deceased PDL, Your Honor, the causes of death of our PDL are cardiovascular disease, then followed by cardiorespiratory arrest, respiratory failure, septic shock, and pneumonia. These are the top five causes of death of our PDL. And for calendar year 2022 alone, the total death of our PDL is 608, Your Honor. And of this number, nandito na din yung ibang mga namatay dahil sa COVID.
So can we have the written report on that, Madam Chair?
We will provide the Honorable Congressman, Your Honor.
Yung rate naman ng COVID vaccination.
I would like to remind the Honorable that you only have 14 seconds left. One last question.
Rate of COVID vaccination in jails and status per jails. Kanino po bang pondo itong ginagamit natin for vaccination, Madam Chair? Umaasa pa rin ba sa LGU?
Mr. Sir, the vaccination of our PDL for COVID vaccinations is from the government talaga ito, Mr. Chair. From the DOH through the LGUs. Galing sa ano, so ni kinakasid sa baba, then doon na nagpa-vaccinate yung mga PDL natin in coordination with the local government units. And for the information of Madam Chair, out of 131,670 PDL, we have 97% are fully vaccinated na po yung mga PDL natin. Almost 127,594 PDL.
Okay, I'm signing for the second round, Madam Chair.
Okay, we'll just list you in the second round. So thank you. Thank you, Deputy Minority Leader Franz Castro. The next to be recognized is Deputy Majority Leader Wheeler Palma.
Fellow workers in government, mayong buntag ka na tong tanan. Sir, kindly, what is the definition of firepower for PNP?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Sir, firepower, sir, is ito po, sir, yung mga kagamitan like mga baril po, sir, short and long firearms po, sir, mga assault rifles po, sir.
All right. I'll go straight to the point. May I suggest, in the event that we will be able to procure these firearms, may I suggest that areas of concern be given priority in the distribution of long firearms, because we need that in our respective localities, especially in the areas of concern. Because if you are going to distribute that in highly urbanized cities and our police personnel are carrying long firearms, it would be, it's not good to see. So if it would be possible to give priority to those areas of concern, for example, in Mindanao areas and some rebel-infested areas, and so on and so forth. And siguro, people from the highly urbanized cities would be considerate enough that the areas to be given are in the areas of concern.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, sir. Actually, sir, that is the way we prioritize po, sir. Doon po sa mga areas of concern po namin, binibigay yung distribution po, sir, ng mga long firearms po namin, sir. Thank you,
so,
sir.
I would expect that in the event that the procurement would be procured, so we expect that the distribution would be given priority to the areas of concern. Madam Chair, if I may, I'd like to address my questions to the Bureau of Fire. Sir, ordinarily in the Armed Forces as well as the PNP, 3 years would be automatic promotion. But in the Bureau of Fire, FO1 to FO2, 10 years, 8 years to 10 years, ano bang sistema? Bakit ang tagal?
Your Honor, my name is Director Louis Puracan, the Chief of the Bureau of Fire Protection. Sir, what happens, sir, is there is really any authorized strength of the Bureau of Fire Protection. Kukunti lang po kasi kami talaga. So, medyo mabagal yung promotion namin. Unlike sa malalaking organization that had armor vacancies. But with the rank modification that we had, we are expecting na pag mataas na yung rango namin, ma-upgrade kami to the 4-star rank, dadami na yung pyramid namin.
Sir, I'm talking FO1 to FO2.
Yes, sir.
Yung mga star, never mind.
Yes, sir.
Fire Officer 1 to Fire Officer 2, minimum of 8 years to 10 years bago yung promotion. Unlike in their counterpart, 3 years, if I stand corrected, dapat ano, sabay-sabay din sila. Kawawa naman yung mga tao natin sa baba eh.
Actually, sir, we will try to look into that, sir, because in the recent years, in the last 2 years, after our rank modification, the average is 5 years.
Sige, sir, I expect that we will review the system of the promotions kasi kawawa naman rin yung ano.
Thank you, sir.
All right, for the BGMP, sir, in your budget for 2023, you requested 1,798 units of short firearm. Is that correct, sir?
That is correct, Mr. Chairman, Your Honor.
Yeah. Madam Chair, with your permission, is the firearms more important than the vehicles? Because when I was governor in Zamboanga, Sibugay, every time there's a hearing, they would request the provincial government to borrow vehicles to transport PDL to the courts. So my question is the short firearms necessary rather than purchasing vehicles to transport PDL to the courts?
Yes, Your Honor, Mr. Chairman. Both are necessary, so we have to prioritize now. Yung sa budget namin, sir, we do have a budget for the purchase of transport vehicle or the prisoner's vans. Then also, because we need also firearms for our personnel. So hinahati-hati na lang namin yung budget, sir.
Madam Chair, sir, short firearms, huh? You cannot use that in the perimeter fence. You need the long M16. These short firearms, I think you have to go over and give priority to the vehicle, because transport vehicle for that matter. Because kawawa yung mga jail officer natin, pupunta ng court, they're using tricycle, you're using private vehicles, and even dump trucks, which is not safe for the PDL as well as to our personnel. That's my suggestion, if we can give priority to this vehicle sana.
Yes, Your Honor.
And kindly take note of that.
Yeah. One last, the good secretary still here. Madam Chair, one last.
Yes,
sir,
one last
Mr.
question.
Secretary, the city of Cebu made a pronouncement, particularly Mayor Rama, regarding the face masks, that it's an optional now in the city of Cebu. I don't know what's happening. What is your stand? Because for us here also, it is very inconvenient also wearing face masks. What's your stand about it, sir?
Thank you for the question, Congressman Palma. Actually, there are right now four laws that I have in mind. It's the national laws, the Bayanihan 1 and 2. And of course, we have the law on the state of calamity and the state of health emergency. And of course, there's this procurement of vaccines. But the most important here is the state of health emergency. I've asked OSG Secretary Maynard Guevara, who was then before my a cabinet member during the time of President Duterte, and he was then the Secretary of Department of Justice. I've asked Secretary Maynard if we are still in a state of health emergency. He said yes. I asked him if this has already been lifted. He said no. So that is the national law. On the other hand, the good mayors have really good intentions for their own LGUs, no? Talaga maganda intention nila, no? They are now claiming the autonomous power under the local government code. Ang sa akin naman, I've been a mayor before, MMDA, now the Secretary of Justice, I try to harmonize both the national and the local. I called up Mayor Mike Rama yesterday when I heard about this pronouncement and told him, Mayor Mike, is it possible for you to defer this executive order? For the simple reason that we could harmonize the national law, of course, and of course, your executive order, para iisang direksyon na lang tayo, iisang sagwan na lang tayo. I promise I will bring this to the IATF next week. And not only that, I would even move that Cebu be a pilot here, since Cebu has always been wanting to have this policy of removing masks on outdoors. But we have to have a process, and we have to have one policy here in the whole country. If Cebu will prove probably in 2 weeks or 3 weeks na po pwede na magmask, why not? At least we have something to start on. And what is more important, we harmonize everything. Mabuti po na lang at napakabait po ni Mayor Mike, pumayag po siya sa suggestion ko. So it is where we are right now, sir. I commit that next week I will bring this matter to the IATF. I've been trying to call up Secretary Berhere here, and once it is there, I also commit that this process should be expedited para wala na po na rin ito. Yun po ang nangyari.
So we are just waiting for the cue from your office because local executives are also waiting for ano ba talaga. So we hope that we can resolve that as soon as possible time. Thank you,
yes, sir.
Mr. Secretary. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much, Deputy Majority Leader Wheeler Palma. So the next to be recognized is the Honorable Minority Leader Marcelino Libano.
Thank you, Madam Chairperson. I would like to apologize that I was not able to arrive early because of previous... We have a lot of ongoing hearings now. Good morning, Secretary Avalos and all the officers and men and women of the ILG. My dear colleagues, I have known Secretary Avalos Group for quite a long time already, since our national movement of young legislators, younger days. And I have known him to be competent, hardworking, intelligent, and diligent person. So that I would like to congratulate him how he handled the national capital region in his response to the pandemic. He was on top of the situation, and we fared well with this period. Madam Chair, the DILG is a unique setup in our government where the officers of the police do not pass through the commission on appointments, but we made the law that it is properly administered by the National Police Commission, so that supervision and operational control shall be with the NAPOLCOM and not reviewed by the Commission on Appointments. Madam Chair, we just like to manifest that we want this law properly implemented, so that we will not have a repeat of what happened during the sub 44, where some of our police sometimes do not know where to listen, and sometimes the secretary was out of the loop in what was happening with the operation. So Madam Chair, just this manifestation, so that Congress will not have to review again this law, and we would like the ILG to succeed, our secretary, our PNP, and all the rest who are with the Department of Interior and local government. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Congressman Libanan. We assure you that with the NAPOLCOM here and with the complete cooperation of the Philippine National Police, these things will be done, sir. I assure you that.
Thank you very much, Secretary Avalos.
So, thank you very much. Are you done, my minority floor leader? Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chairperson. Yes, that manifestation.
Okay, so the next to be recognized is the Representative Edsel Lagman. Manong Edsel. Yes.
Thank you.
Representative Edsel Lagman. You're recognized.
Can I speak, Madam Chair? Good morning to our distinguished former colleague, the Honorable Secretary Benhor Abalos of the Department of the Interior and Local Government. I do not have any questions, but may I request the DILG to submit the following to the Committee on Appropriations, copy furnish this representation. One, position paper on the DILG's stand on Executive Order Number 138 issued by former President Rodrigo Duterte on June 1, 2021 relative to the Mandanas-Garcia Supreme Court ruling. Two, list of DILGs who have been made, the list of LGUs as qualified beneficiaries of the Growth Equity Fund under the LGSF. And third and last, list of barangays cleared of communist infiltration or influence which are qualified for support to barangays under the LGSF. That would be all, Madam Chair, and thank you, Mr. Secretary.
May we request the Secretary of the ILG to take note of those requested documents, and may we request the department to please furnish a copy of the Committee on Appropriations so that the committee will provide a copy to the Honorable Edsel Lagman.
Yes, Mama Chairperson, and I assure my esteemed former colleague, Congressman Edsel Lagman, I haven't seen you for quite a long time, sir. You're looking good. I assure you, sir, we will give to you the documents, sir. Maraming salamat po. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Secretary. Thank you. So the next to be recognized is the Deputy Majority Leader, Jose Bong Tebes Jr.
Madam Chair, fellow colleagues, Secretary Abalos, and the DILG family, good morning. Mr. Secretary, last month the Commission of Audit flagged the DILG for the 577 million pesos unspent COVID-19 funds which are intended for the payment of COVID-19 contact tracers hired by the DILG. Ano na po ang nangyari? Nabayaran na po ba ito lahat?
Okay, may we get a response from the DILG?
Madam Chair, and with the permission of the Secretary, I am ASEC Esther Aldana, ASEC for Finance and Controllership. The COWA audit says that out of 577,053 million as of December 31, 2021, out of this amount, a total of 436 million was reverted, while 140 million is part of the continuing appropriation in 2022. As of July 31, out of the 140 million, 116 million has been obligated for the contact tracing, providing balance of 23 million as of July 31. The balance now is being utilized for the payment of services rendered of contact tracers up to August 31, 2022. Other claims also that will cover operational expenses of the contact tracers like traveling, communication, and payment of salaries of administrative staff in charge of the preparation of financial reports in contact tracing fund will be utilized until the end of the year. Mr. Chairman, Your Honor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In 2018, the Supreme Court through the Mandanas ruling expanded the LGU external revenue share. Ibig sabihin po nito, lalaki po ang IRA ng bawat LGUs. But Ang nangyari po ngayon, maraming mga lokal ang mas bumaba ang kanilang mga natatanggap na ERA year this year.
Madam Chair, and with the permission of Secretary Abalos, sir, for 2022, across all local government units, there is an increase in their national tax allocation share of around 37.8%. But as mentioned by Secretary Abalos, for 2023, there will be a decrease of more or less 14% because of the decrease in collection of taxes, no, in 2020. But for 2022, sir, there is an increase of, on the average, 37.8% national tax allocation share of LGUs.
Mas tataas ngayon o bababa?
Comparing 2021 and 2022, there is an increase of 37% for 2022.
But now there's a decrease for 2023, right?
That's correct, Madam Chair.
But yung mga third, mga fourth, fifth class municipalities, even the province, nagreklamo dahil bumaba ang kanilang ERA compared sa last year.
Madam Chair, we have to check on that because what we know is there is an increase of 37.8% comparing ERA 2021 and national tax allocation share 2022.
Yes, there's, because that's provided in the law, in the local government code, that there has always been an increase in the internal revenue allotment. But with the NTA now, kawawa yung mga LGU because a lot will be devolved. And then, ngayon, ang laki ng bawas.
Kasi, Madam Chair, based dun sa kanilang natanggap na information last previous administration, tataas ang kanilang ERA. But yung actual na natanggap nila is mababa kaysa kanilang notice noong nakalaang taon. Paki-double check na lang po ito kasi ito po ay nangyari sa bayan ng aking anak na siya po ang mayor sa Catanduanes. Na instead na tumaas dahil nga sa Mandanas Law, maraming pa-meeting, maraming posisyon na kinreate, pero mas lalong bumaba ang ERA na natatanggap nila.
Sir, papa-check na lang po namin.
Check na lang po.
Kasi po, theoretically, dapat tumaas po sila.
Yes po.
By next year, bababa po.
At my third question po ay, Madam Chair, Mr. Secretary, gusto ko pong malaman kung ang design ng mga pinapatayo niyong mga police station ay pare-parehas. Kasi nung panahon po na Typhoon Rolly sa probinsya po ng Catanduanes, lahat po ng mga tinamaan doon na bayan, bagsak lahat ang mga police station. Even konkrito po ang kanilang mga dingding, pero ang yero po, ang bubong po ay yero. Baka po pwedeng i-reconsider nyo ito sa mga area ng mga typhoon prone tulad ng Batanes, Catanduanes at iba pa na talagang iba po ang standard o design na inyong gagawin para hindi po nasasayang ang pabalik-balik na repair tuwing magkakaroon po ng malakas na typhoon sa area nila. Ma-identify naman po natin ito kung saan po yung mga area o province na mamalakas at palaging tinatamaan ng bagyo.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, sir. Yes, sir. We are currently, sir, conducting a review on the design of the different police stations nationwide out of the 1,172 police stations. Parang sa ganun po ay hindi nga po sila nasisira pag dumarating po ang malalakas na bagyo, Your Honor, sir.
Thank you po. For my last question, Madam Chairman.
Yes, please proceed.
Ilan po ang nakakasuhan sa Republic Act 9003 ng DILG? As a former mayor po, marami rin dito akong mga kasama na kinasuhan na sa Republic Act 9003 ng DILG. Dahil hindi naman nila kayang magpagawa ng sarili nilang sanitary landfill. At talaga namang kung ikaw ay third, fifth, fourth class municipalities, hindi mo kayang magpagawa ng sanitary landfill. Pero kahit ipakulong nyo po ang mga mayor na walang kakayahan dahil napakaliit po ng pondo nito. Alam ko po, alam na intindihan po yan ni Secretary Abalos dahil siya po ay former mayor. Wala pong kakayahan. yan po ang mga daing ng mga local government kung paano natin matutulungan. Ang isa pong nakikita ko diyan ay nagbibigay po kayo ng mga LGSF o assistance fund sa mga LGO. Bakit hindi na lang po ninyo i-identify yung mga hindi kayang magpagawa ng sanitary landfill ay doon nyo ipa-allocate, ilagay nyo as specific sa LGSF ninyo na ang pondong itutulong ninyo ay gagamitin sa pagpapagawa ng sanitary landfill. Tulad nung sa 20% po natin, siguro sa mga mayors dito, alam po yan ni Mayor Secretary Abalos, na meron po tayo nakalagay doon na intended for 5% kana 5% calamity fund. Hindi mo po pwedeng gamitin kahit sa ang pondo kundi sa kalamidad lamang. Bakit hindi tayo maglagay doon sa inyong itinutulong sa pondo coming from the DILG na na para lamang ito sa gagamitin sa sanitary landfill.
Okay.
Lastly na lang po para siguro hindi na ako sagutin.
Okay, you only have 13 seconds left.
Lastly,
Congressman.
Lastly po, as a former vice chairman ng 18th Congress at Committee on Local Government and a former mayor and former vice governor, I always support the funding of the allocation of fund approved budget of the DILG. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much.
If I might respond.
Deputy Majority, yes, may we hear a response?
Una, taos po kami nagpapasalamat for your support to the DILG. Pangalawa, all of your observations are valid. I come from a small city in Metro Manila, which is Mandaluyong. Wala po kami tapunan dito. Kaya ang buong Metro Manila, nagsanid pwersa para magkaroon kami ng MMDA na siya nag-identify. It's about time that we review this. Naniniwala pa ako sa sinasabi ninyo. Talagang marami talagang mahihirapan po rito. Ang nag-handle po rito ay ang National Solid Waste Management. No? In fact, plano commission. In fact, pinag-usapan po namin ito ng Secretary ng DNR, si Secretary Tony Loizaga. No? Binigyan niya ako ng mga listahan. And probably one of these days, pwede po natin upuan ito to review this policy para makatulungan naman on the part of the executive and of course of Congress. No? Pabayaan niyo po, a-actionan po namin kaagad po ito. Maraming salamat po ulit.
Yes.
Thank you very much po, Mr. Secretary. Thank you very much po sa DILG family. Maraming salamat.
Thank you very much, Secretary Abalos, for looking into this. Dahil yung ibang mayors, kuminsan, nasasampahan ng kaso because they do not have a sanitary landfill na has been mentioned earlier by Representative Tevez. They do, the LGUs, particularly those in the fifth class municipality, they do not have the capability of, you know, constructing a million worth of sanitary landfill. And thank you. At least you're doing something about this.
Actually, ma'am, there's a list that I'm now compiling that should really be reviewed, that are provided for by law, but, you know, on the ground, they cannot just really do it.
Yeah,
paggawa lang ng plano, wala silang mga engineer.
Yeah.
Kailangan patulungan what more things like this.
Yeah. Maraming
we're making
salamat,
this list
Secretary,
at matulungan na lang po. Salamat po.
For your concern. So next to be recognized is from the minority, the Honorable Bonifacio Basita.
Madam Chair, my colleagues, fellow sa public servants, magandang umaga po sa ating lahat. As public servant and retired police commission officer, ako po ay natutuwa na ang natalaga na secretary ng DILG ay isang lawyer. At bilang isang matagal sa government na nanungkulan, no, ako po ay nasa PNP pa, kilala po na isa sa mga dedicated and excellent public servant ang buting secretary ng DILG. At isa pong magandang opportunity ito, hindi lang para sa akin, kundi para sa ating mga kababayan. Madam Chair, may lumabas po na Joint DILG DOTC Memorandum Circular noong 2008. At ito naman po ay base sa Republic Act 4136, also known as Land Transportation and Traffic Code of the Philippines. Sabi po sa paragraph 3.4 on the issuance of citation ticket states that the LGUs can issue traffic citation tickets, but only the LTO and their deputized agents can confiscate driver's license. Madam Chair, araw-araw po, gabi-gabi, minuto-minuto, marami pong mga motorista ang kaawa-awa at napiperwisyo. Kabilang na rin po dito ang kanilang pamilya. Para po maging malinaw ito sa lahat, especially sa buting sekretary po ng DILG. Halimbawa po, ang isang motorista na galing sa Cavite ay nadako sa Isabela. At dahil po sa minor violation, traffic violation, siya po ay nahuli. Kukumpiskahin po ng police o ng enforcer ang kanyang lisensya at bibigyan po siya ng traffic citation ticket. Paglabas po ng naturang bayan, siya po ay malaki ang possibility at talaga namang nangyayari. Dadaan po siya sa checkpoint. Pagdaan po niya sa checkpoint, huhulihin na naman siya ng police. At kapag kanyang naipresenta ang hawak ng ticket, kinukumpiska po ang kanyang sasakyan at sinasabing may violation siya na driving without license. Nakakatuwa po na ang ating buting secretary, DILG, ay isang lawyer. At dahil po dito, ako po'y naniniwala na ito po ay bibigyan niya ng proper attention. Simple lamang, Madam Chair. Sinasabi po ng batas at yan naman po ay nabanggit ng buting DILG Secretary doon sa isang post niya na that we as public servants dapat tayong sumunod at dapat tayong marunong magpasunod ng batas. Madam Chair, marami po ang nagsasuffer nating mga kababayan at ako po'y naniniwala na wala nang iba pang magbibigay ng attention dito sa problemang ito na dinadanas ng maraming motorista araw-araw, gabi-gabi, kundi ang butihing sekretary ng DILG. Kaya, in behalf of the motorists nationwide, hinihiling ko po, Madam Chair, na sa ngalan po ng batas at sa ngalan po ng public service, hinihiling po na sana immediately ay mabigyan po ito ng attention ng butihin nating Secretary ng DILG. Maraming salamat po, Madam
okay,
Chair.
Thank you. Thank you, Representative Busita.
If I may yes. response, actually,
yes, Secretary.
Yung pong sinasabi ni Congressman Busita ay talagang valid at nangyayari po ngayon. No? Kuminsan, nauhuli ka sa isang lugar, bibigyan ka ng ticket ng isang lungsod na yon. Pagpunta mo sa kabila, pwede pa nilang hindi i-recognize ito. At yung sinasabi niya rin about the LTO law, no? Totoo po iyon. So again, ito na naman, lumalabas na naman kuminsan sa dami ng autonomy against the LTO law, no? Ang epekto na ang ating motorista ay naapektuhan ng gusto. I wrote this concern, I wrote a letter to LTO, yung pong dinulog niyo sa amin ito, no? Para mabigyan once and for all. Sumulat po kami. At humihingi kami ng dialogo para once and for maupuan na po natin ito. So that, you know, our department is about governance. We've got the local government code. We recognize the autonomy of each and every LGU, especially about traffic. However, lumalabas yung ganito problema. How do we now treat this one? So, sumulat kami sa LTO, uupuan po namin ito, and on our side, titignan namin, ipapasa namin sa Congress kung ano legislation ang po pwede po tungkol dito. But rest assured, Congressman Busita, we will take care of this issue and we will be in constant touch with your office. as we have had before.
Okay. Yes, Congressman, 30 seconds left.
What happened? Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. Point of clarification lang po, Mr. Secretary. Nabanggit po ninyo na magkakaroon kayo ng dialogo. Ang tanong ko lamang po, with all due respect, anyway, hindi po ako lawyer, ano po, at kayo po ay lawyer. Bakit po kailangan pang magkaroon muna ng dialogo para mabigyan ito ng attention, samantalang nakasad na po ito sa Republic Act 4136? Kasi po, Mr. Chair, araw-araw po, marami nagsasuffer dito. Kagabi lamang po, may isang truck driver na huli po sa, I think, kung hindi po nagkakamali dahil maraming tumatawag sa amin. Driver po ng truck, nahuli sa Pasig City area. At kinumpiskahan po siya ng lisensya. And the following day, nung minamaneho niya po niya, Mr. Madam Chair, yung kanyang motorsiklo, unfortunately, nahuli naman po siya ng enforcer.
Can you wind up, Congressman? Your time expired.
Thank you, Madam Chair. May I continue, Madam Chair?
Just briefly.
Yes po. So, ang nangyari po, dahil po doon sa sistema na hindi natin naipapatupad ng tama ang batas, inimpound po ng enforcer ng Bacoor City ang motorsiklo ng kaawa-awang truck driver na puyat, pagod, gutom, galing sa trabaho. Ngayon po, absent na naman po siya dahil wala po siya perang pantubos. So, my point is, Madam Chair, we are public servants. May batas po. Bakit hindi natin maipatupad para sa ganoon po, hindi kaawa-awa ang mga kapatid nating motorista na nagsisikap na mabuhay ng marangal at mabuhay ang kanilang pamilya sa maayos na pamamaraan.
Okay.
Madam Chair.
So maybe maybe request the DILG to take note of the
yes,
statement
thank you.
Of
yes,
Representative Busita.
Yes, Congressman Busita.
So,
no?
Will there be a response coming?
Yes.
Okay. So okay. May the chair now recognize the Honorable Representative Faustino D.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good morning na din po sa ating mga kasamahan, sa ating Secretary ng DILG, Secretary Avalos, at sa DILG family. Pagtapos po ng ating mga series of lockdowns from 2020 to 2021, nakakita po tayo ng pagtaas po ng ating mga kaso sa teenage pregnancies po. In fact po, ang Region 2, Madam Chair, ay top contender po tayo dito pagdating po sa mga kaso ng teenage pregnancy. Can we ask the NYC kung meron po silang mga programa na kaakibat dito at kung may pondo?
May I request the Vice Chair in charge of the National Aid Commission, Honorable Representative Vice Chairperson Carl Nicholas Carey. Okay, I think there's like a question. That's why.
You may proceed, NYC.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Regarding the question on teenage pregnancy, the former President Duterte signed EO 141 June 2021 to mobilize the government on this matter, sir. And the NYC was tasked to provide forums for the youth, for them to understand this problem, sir. And on our part, since last year, we have provided webinars to expound on this issue. And we are mobilizing the Sangguniang Kabataan to further inform the youth on this matter. For this year, on the first quarter, we had our SK National Summit, and this was one of the issues tackled. And we gathered around 1,000 SK leaders, mostly federation presidents, and this was one of the issues. For the second semester, we had four webinars, sir, regarding this issue again. And on the next 6 months, we will be having three island-based workshops regarding teenage pregnancy, one in Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. Unfortunately, for 2023, we do not have enough budget, sir. And we are asking Congress to assist us, sir.
Maraming salamat, Ginoong Cardema. Ako po kasi ay naniniwala kapag ang kapwa kabataan o ang barkada o kaibigan ang nagpaliwanag tungkol sa mga paghihirap po ng isang kabataan pagdating po sa teenage pregnancy, mas madali mapaniwalaan o maintindihan po ng ating mga kabataan. Sana nga po mapondohan po natin to para sa 2023 para ma-resolve po tong issue pagdating po sa teenage pregnancy. Maraming salamat po, Madam Chair. Yun na po ang aking question.
Thank you. Okay. So, are you satisfied with that?
Done na.
Okay, so you're done. So thank you very much, Congressman Mike D. The next to be recognized is from the minority, the Honorable Deputy Minority Leader Bernadette Herrera.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Magandang tanghali po sa DILG Family Secretary. Good afternoon po. My questions is for the Bureau of Fair Protection through you, Madam Chair. Under the proposed budget ng BFP, ang capital outlay nyo is 416 million. Pwede po bang malaman ano yung mga capital outlays for 2023? Through you, Madam Chair.
So maybe get an answer from the BFP.
With the permission of
that's
the Secretary,
on capital outlay.
I may answer, ma'am. For the capital outlay, ma'am, it is for the procurement of fire trucks and procurement of the fire stations.
Okay. Pero dun sa object of expenditure sa NEP, ang capital outlay is 1.416 billion. Saan po kukunin yung 1 billion?
The 1 billion, ma'am, will be coming from the SEGF. It's from the fund of or the fire code fees collection.
Yes, so yung fire code fees kasi automatic appropriation to eh, di ba?
Yes, ma'am.
So, paano ang process ng approval nun considering it doesn't pass through Congress kasi dahil nasa automatic na siya?
As we all know, ma'am, automatic na po talaga to sa amin.
Yeah, ma'am. Kanino kayo humihingi ng approval para bigyan kayo ng 1 billion? Because the fire code fees has a balance of 4.6 billion pa, 4.8 billion pa ang balance nito. How do you decide bakit 1 billion ang i-request nyo? Sino nag-a-approve? Who do you ask for approval?
Through the years, ma'am, we are requesting...
Through
the years, ma'am, we've been requesting for an increase from 1 billion. But unfortunately, the DBM only give us 1 billion per annum, despite of the increase of the balances of the fire code fees.
So it's DBM who gives the approval,
ma'am,
for this.
That's
are you aware that in case maubos nyo yung 1 billion, you can request any time of the year?
Yes, ma'am, we are aware of that, ma'am.
Okay.
So I would just like to be clarified that. Excuse
yeah, go ahead,
me, Representative Herrera. Is this the trust fund that you're talking about? It's the collection of the fire Bureau of Fire in the different LGUs, isn't it? There's this fire code fee. Is it fire code fee?
Yes, ma'am. That's correct, ma'am. The fire code fees.
In a year, for the whole LGU, magkano yung collection nila for this fee, fire code fee?
The average collection, ma'am, is 2.5 billion per annum.
Billion.
Billion, ma'am.
Billion. Okay. And how much, isn't it? There's a sharing for this?
20%, ma'am, of the collections goes to the LGU. 80% goes to the Bureau of Fire Protection.
So it's 20%
the 20% goes to the LGU concern. And then yours is?
80%.
Yun ba yung collection ninyo? Are you, where do you remit? Is it in the National Treasury or yung counterpart ng LGU, papaano yun? Naiiwan ba yan? Or nire-remit nyo ba sa LGU concern?
All of the collections from the fire code fees goes to BTR. Then the remaining, the 20% will be returned to the LGU through the DBM.
Okay, can you please give me an update? Excuse me, we have Representative Herrera, inasmuch as this is connected to, yes, the capital outlay that you're asking. Paano yun? How would like an LGU know that ito yung share ninyo? Are the different station, your BFP station, are you reporting to the municipal or the local chief executive na, sir, ma'am, ganito po yung share ninyo, it's 20%, and for the collection of this year, ganito po yan na collection natin. So supposedly, for the next year, or I don't know how we do it, dapat ganito po ang matatanggap natin from the DBM. Can you please give us an update? Kasi just a while ago, the majority floor leader was asking me too about this.
We will do that, ma'am.
Gaano ba katagal bago maghintay ang LGU?
Ma'am, the mechanics is, all the fire code fees collection goes through BTR, and the BTR will certify the amount. So the LGU knows how much of the total fees collected, the 20% of that will be going again to the LGU. Ibabalik po sa LGU. Alam na po ng munisipal ng treasurer kung magkano yung
ibabalik. So wala tayong reklamo sa mga LCEs?
Actually, ma'am, may kunti lang problema dahil sa reconciliation ng records.
Kasi may mga nagre-reklamo din eh. I think the majority floor leader was asking me earlier. Kasi in Zamboanga City daw, nasaan na daw yung share ng... you know, LGU ng Zamboanga.
We have already released some of the 20%, however, ma'am.
But how long?
There were still unreconciled records between the BEP records and the BTR records.
Oh, yun ang problema.
Okay, kindly furnish us a copy.
Opo, ma'am. Opo, ma'am.
I think that's also one of the concerns of the Honorable Herrera. Okay. Please continue, Congressman Herrera.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Pasubmit na lang po siguro yung breakdown. Pero linawin ko lang, sir, yung 2.5 na sinasabi mo is 80% already. So, mas malaki pa yung collection. Kasi dito sa fire code fees, yearly, 2.2 for 2021, 2.5 for 2022. But this composes 80%. So outside pa dito yung 20% na tinatanong ng ating Madam Chair.
Ma'am, the 2.5 collection from June to from January to June this year, gross pa po yan.
So that's 100%.
Yes, ma'am.
Kasi ang nakalagay dito sa particulars, it is already 80% of the fees. If you look at table B15,
ma'am, in our records, ma'am, maybe you are referring to 2021. 2.2. No, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. That's correct, ma'am. 2.5 actually, ma'am, per books in the year 2021.
So meaning, yung nakalagay dito is 2.2 is 80%, but the total is 2.5, meaning 300 million was supposed to go to the LGUs.
That's correct, ma'am. 20%.
So maybe you can submit to us how these were distributed so that all LGUs are aware at kung ano yung sinasabing discrepancies para alam namin.
We will do that, ma'am.
Through you, Madam Chair. And also, Madam Chair, can you submit to us na lang yung 1.416 billion capital expenditures, kung ano-ano yon?
Yes, ma'am. We will do that, ma'am.
And then, through you, Madam Chair, may balak ba tayo yung capital outlay for this year, idadaan po ba natin ulit sa PSDBM or sa PITC?
Actually, ma'am, for three years now, the BAP is conducting its own procurement.
Wala nang dadaan. Kahit yung fire code fees procurement, wala nang dadaan sa PITC and PSDBM.
That's correct, Your Honor.
Okay. Now I go to the 2021 COA annual audit report of the BFP states that the year-end balance due from GOCC's account of 3.267 billion is unreliable due to unrecognized funds, refunds, cancellation fee and interest income totaling 217.617 million in NHQ and NCR, and a variance of 1.589 million between records of PITC and BFP fund. Further fund transfers from NHQ, NCR, and Region 3 totaling 3.267 billion remain unsettled at year-end due to inability of PITC to deliver the goods and complete the projects despite the lapse of more than 4 years. 4 years na po ito, ano po bang balak natin para ma-recover? Tayo ba, mababawi ba natin yung pondo o magde-deliver na po finally ang PITC sa atin?
Ma'am, as of June 30 of 2022, of the total 3.89 billion projects transferred to PITC, 92% were completed. And the only remaining funds that we have now and subject to revision, for reversion to VTR is 11,777,116. The 11 million is the savings out of the construction of the fire stations, but this cannot be turned over to BTR unless after the completion of the project. So we have now only
when
one.
When do we expect the completion of the project?
By November this year, ma'am.
Okay, so please report that to us.
Thank you. We will that move.
Through you, Madam Chair, same COA report. The balance of accounts due from NGAs amounting to 514.39 million is unreliable due to unreconciled variance. Dahil nga sa PSDBM and BFP. Tapos yung accumulated balance from prior years fund transfers aged 1 to 16 years totaling 511 million remained unremitted to the BTR. Moreover, funds transferred to the DILG in the amount of 2 billion remained unliquidated as of December 2021. Paano po ba i-rectify ng BFP ito, itong glaring budget malpractices natin?
Regarding the funds transferred to PSDBM, the total funds transferred is 1,489,729,000. And out of that, the unimplemented projects, because of the cancelled projects, is 591,070,647. The total funds reverted to BTR is 775,177,000. The only completed projects, ma'am, out of the 1.4 billion is 898,000,000.
So ano pong balak natin dito pa natin ayusin?
Na-reverted na po, ma'am, yung funds.
Everything?
No, ma'am. Out of the 1.4 billion transferred from BAP to PSDBM, only 898 million are completed and delivered projects. The remaining 775 million were reverted to BTR.
So na-revert na?
Opo,
so okay na tong COA report na to?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. For this 2022, wala na tayong bidding sa PITC and PSDBM?
That's correct.
Okay. So, pa-submit na lang po through you, Madam Chair, yung mga ni-request natin na submittals, pati yung mga ongoing and planned purchases ng fire code fees for this year. Kasi blind po kami dito pagdating sa fire code fees na capital expenditure.
We will do that, ma'am.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Okay, your time expired, Hong? So may we get a response from the BFP, is it? And may we request the BFP please to furnish
the copies the documents requested being requested by
we will do
the Honorable Herrera.
We will do that
to the Committee on Appropriation, and we'll just furnish the Honorable B.H. Herrera.
Thank you, ma'am.
A copy of your report. So, maraming salamat. Maraming salamat po, Representative Bernadette B.H. Herrera. So, the next to be recognized is Representative Jefferson Conju.
Magandang hapon po, Mr. Secretary, at saka kay Chief Asrin, good afternoon, at sa lahat po ng mga taga-DLG. First question po, sir, sa ating pong secretary, may balak po ba tayo mag-procure ng mga vehicles, patrol cars, fire trucks, helicopters, ngayong taon po na to?
Oh, well, I'm sure meron po ang PNP, ang BFP, no, at even ang BGMP. Meron po silang procurement just so na-maintain po yan every year.
Okay, sir. Kasi, sir, naalala ko, during these past years, nag-procure ang PNP, hindi ko alam kung through DILG, no, ng mga Mahindra, which is alam naman natin yung mga Mahindra, hindi na nagamit, hindi na... halos hindi na nagamit, hindi na pakinabangan na matagal, puro sira ang nangyari, walang spare parts, walang piyesa, lahat. Sir Secretary, pwede niyo po bang i-assure, dahil galing din po ako sa local government, dahil naging mayor po ako ng Subic ng 9 years, pwede niyo po bang ipangako sa amin na hindi na ito mauulit dahil yung mga naging epekto ng mga na-procure na mga vehicles na yon, eh yung mga mayors ang, sa totoo lang, mga local chief executive ang sumasalo dahil sa hirap ng mga pulis natin na pag nasisiraan, eh tayo ang sumasagot ng kanilang mga vehicles. Can you assure us, Sir Secretary, na sa susunod na mag-procure ang PNP, ang fire, ng, ano, at saka ang Bureau of Fire ng mga vehicles natin, eh magiging maintenance-friendly at hindi ganun kahirap i-maintain yung mga ganung klaseng mga vehicles na pinoprocure natin?
Well, una-una, tama po observation ninyo. No? I've been a chief executive before. Talaga ang mga local executives po ang laking tulong sa kapulisan, sa BFP, sa BGMP. Talagang ang dami po nilang donasyon dito. Even the patrol cars, halos lahat po talaga nagbibigay. Kami po ang PNP, ang BFP, ang BGMP may stand alone back po yan eh, no? Pero of course, yung sa specifications pwede naman po naming ma-review po yan at siya paano makapag-suggest sa kanila. Sa akin ang ipapangako ko po ngayon, ito po on record, is that the Mahindra days will be gone. Hindi dapat ganun. When you're going to purchase a vehicle, it should be a vehicle na number one, madaling kumuha ng spare parts. Number two, nakakahabol, di na iiwan. At number three, hindi nasasayang lamang ang pera. I can assure you of that, no? So, siguro, in relation to this, Chief PNP, Iral, and BGMP, Director Iral, hindi lang ako magkukumita, dapat tayong apat ngayon. Dahil individual back kayo. We should commit right now on record when we purchase vehicles, for that matter. It should be vehicles that is roadworthy, mabilis-mabili ang mga spare parts, at nakakahabol. The Mahindra days will be gone. Okay? We assure you that. Chief PNP?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, sir. We'll ensure po na hindi na po maulit po yung nangyari sa Mahindra, sir.
Chief Iro?
On the part of the BGMP, we assure the Honorable Congressman that we will purchase a very reliable vehicle for our prisoner's funds.
Chief Parukan.
On behalf of the Bureau of Fire Protection, sir, we assure you that the equipment and the vehicles that we will buy is really available in the market and it is very reliable.
Thank you very much.
Sir, if I might point out, no?
Yes, go ahead, sir.
As has been pointed out before, Kumisan, yung alam mo yung sa bidding, yung lowest price,
yung nagiging problema. Yung PSDBN yata ang nagpro-procure.
Oo, eh. Kumisan, yung lowest price, it's not even yung, dapat talaga ma-review rin yung procurement law. It's not always the lowest. Kuminsan na sa sacrifice po yun.
The policy of the government?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Kasi nabalitaan ko nga dati, nag-procure ang, ano, ang PNP ng mga choppers. Muntik nang nadali yung PNP chief natin nung sumaki sa chopper na nakaraan. Naalala niyo po ba yun? Sumabit sa kuryente. So, ako po, eh, gusto ko lang po na masiguro na yung pera ng ating gobyerno ay napupunta sa tamang paggamit, lalong-lalo na po sa pag-procure ng mga vehicles. Again, maraming salamat, Secretary, sa assurance po na yan. Second, sir, ano po bang ano, nangyari doon sa educational assistance ng DSWD? I believe na nagkaroon po kayo ng memorandum of agreement ng ating Secretary. Ano po ba ang ano? Ano po ba ang kinalaman ng DILG doon?
Well, ganito po kasi yan, no? If you will recall before nung pandemya, meron tayong mga ayuda. At mahirap kasi noon dahil hindi ito po delineated ano ang role ng DILG, ng LGU, ni governor, ni mayor, at anong role ng DSWD. So nung naglabas ng listahan ang DSWD, akala ng mga tao may kinalaman si governor, si mayor. Kuminsan yung pera, ang akala pa galing pa sa kay mayor, no? Kaya nakakasisihan, nakakaturuan, no? So we made sure this time, kinausap po Secretary Erwin Tulfo, sabi ko, sir, let's delineate, tutulong po kami. Dapat magkatulungan tayo. Pero bago mangyari po ito, is it possible for us, let's delineate. Number one, ang listahan ng beneficiary nitong AIX or Assistance to Individuals in Crisis should all come from DSWD. Number two, yung paymaster, huwag nyo na i-download yung pera sa LGU. Kasi once i-download nyo, ang magliliquidate niyan ang LGU. Magkakaproblema, tapos kayo magdidikta. If it's better, yun na lang paymaster na national ang magbibigay ng pera. Ngayon, kung paymaster na national, may kulang kayo sa manpower dahil malaki Pilipinas. Diyan papasok ang mga mayors at governors. We will give you additional manpower. We will give you additional sites kung kinakailangan. At yung mga police, tutulong kami rito. Because the trick here is to have an online registration. Once it is online, kailangan tabuyin mo kagad yung mga hindi nakarehistro ng online. Otherwise, dadami ang tao. So yun po ang trick doon. Na-control yung dami ng tao, at the same time, pinaalis po kaagad yung mga nasusumikse. So it's a good example na pagkakaisa ng LGUs kasama ang DSWD. Wala akong gulo.
Nasunod po ba yung inyong mga recommendations, Secretary?
Recommendations po?
Doon sa ano, ng DSWD sa usapan
well,
ninyo?
Well, this could be used as a template dahil we cannot tell kamukha ng mga ayuda, kung ano pa mangyari in the future. This could be a very good template between the LGUs and of course the national of DSWD, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary.
Thank you.
Again, sir, pag-usapan naman po natin yung devolution. Alam naman po natin na by next year, katulad nga ng sinabi ni sir kanina, bababa ng almost 15% ang IRA ng local government unit. At alam din naman natin na dahil sa devolution, madadagdagan ng pondo ang ating mga lokal na pamahalaan. Pero tingin namin is hindi magiging sapat dahil sa responsibilidad na nadagdag kaakibat ng pagdagdag ng pondo. Don't you think, Secretary, na by next year, mas mahihirapan ang ating mga lokal na pamahalaan? Tingin niyo po ba na dapat muna nating suspindihin muna ang ano, ang devolution or magsakripisyo ang national government para balikatin yung ibang responsibilidad na iniatang ninyo sa ating mga lokal na pamahalaan?
Sa totoo lang po kasi, we have to balance everything. Ang nawala sa national ay malaki rin with our debt. At the same time, with the Mandanas ruling, binawasa talaga siya malaking pera. On the other hand, sa LGUs naman ho, binigyan siya ng pera, pero sinabi sa kanya, magmula ngayon, kung ano nakasaad sa libro, which is the local government code, strictly, let's implement it, at ito mga gagawin mo. So medyo nakabiglaan. It's a very delicate balance, Congressman. Ang ginagawa ngayon ng DILG ay tinitingnan namin anong feasible at anong hindi feasible. Saan tatama ito at tingin namin anong pinakamalaking tatamaan. At napakaswerte po natin dahil ang ating Pangulo ay dating gobernador. Ang ating Pangulo ay dating kongresista na siyang chairperson noon ng Local Government Committee. At siya rin ang chairperson ng Local Government Committee, siya ay senador. In short, pro-LGU po siya. Kaya ang bili niya, tignan mo, Bernhard, kung ano yung talagang practical, kung ano kailangan. Where we strike a good balance here, na ang ano rito ay talagang it is justified for both. No? So yung po tinitin namin, like for example, ang number one concern is this construction and maintenance of school building. Kaya pa ba ito ng LGU? Kaya ba ng 6th class, 5th class, 4th class? Kaya ba nila mayor to? Paano for the next coming years? Baka lalo tayo makakulangan sa eskwelahan, no? Kaya nga, ewan ko kung meron pa kayong menu dito sa Congress, paggawa ng eskwela, kung wala na. No?
Ano po ang recommendation niyo sa aking presidente?
Well, ang sa presidente is that right now, talagang we are at the process kung saan ini-evaluate po talaga namin ang tama sa bawat isa. At titignan po namin kung po pwedeng tumulong ang national government. Pero of course, it's a delicate balance dahil nabawasan rin siya ng malaki. No? So, ang sagot po rito is the equity fund na meron tayo, yung kanina diniscuss po natin. No? Bibigyan muna namin. And ngayon po, binibenchmark po namin lahat. And of course, constant dialogue with the different leagues, with the League of Governors, League of Mayors, kung anong tama. Kasi sa ngayon, may pera pa po sila eh. No? Pero ito'y paghahanda hanggang next year.
Okay. Sir Secretary, gusto ko lang po malaman, sa estado naman po ng ating mga ano, ng mga kulungan dito sa bansa, alam naman po natin, galing din po kayo sa lokal na pamahalan sa LGU, at nakita niyo po yung sobrang sikip ng ating mga ano, kulungan dito sa ating bansa. Ano po bang pwedeng gawing hakbang bilang pinuno po ng DILG patungkol po dito sa, alam naman natin na sa sobrang puno ng ating mga kulungan, eh minsan nakakabahala na din.
Well, kung may isang kulungang matindi, dito lang ho, sa kanto, San Mateo, katabing-katabi ng Congress, kano katindi? Yung mga preso bago matulog may schedule.
Totoo po.
May schedule, ha? I mean, you have to sit down and then if you have to lie down, you have to be scheduled. At not only that, nung bagyo na malakas, kailangan i-evacuate ang mga preso dahil baka malunod sa kulungan. So, I've asked the mayor and I've asked the congressman if they have a property. Kasi isang requirement po, magdo-donate ang local government unit. So what I did, naging mayor din ho naman ako, dahil sa ibang mayor, mahirap mag-donate talaga at dahil wala i-donate. Ang ginawa ko, use of rack. Ibig sabihin, baka po pwedeng pahiram nyo ng long term ang lupa ninyo. Let's say 30 years, 40 years, and the ownership remains with the LGU. At mapagawa namin. Kaya inaantay ko po iyon para masaya paano mapondohan at maihabol ko po rito para mapagawa na po San Mateo. Pinapalista ko yung other congested areas, no, bawat region, para mapagawa po ng programa. Although I would say there are provincial jails, nasagot ng probinsya, there are some city jails na talagang ang city na ho ang nagpapagawa at ako'y nagpapasalamat sa kanila.
Thank you very much, Secretary. And my last question po sa PNP, ano po ba ang ratio ng ano? Nang may pulis natin na may baril ngayon. Dati po kasi may kakulangan tayo ng mga baril. Ngayon po ba is 1:1 na?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, sir. As of now po, sir, yung baril po natin, sir, ay... Ang fill up po natin sa baril, sir, ay... 100% na po, sir.
100% po.
Sa short firearm po, sir. Sa short
firearm. Ibig po sabihin, hindi na po nagsusubsidize ang sariling o bumibili yung mga pulis natin ang sarili nilang barel.
Yes, sir. Pagka na-procure na po natin, sir, yung 4,100 na barrel next year, sir, ang fill up na po natin ay 100% po, sir.
Ano po ang mga tatak na barrel na binibili po natin?
It's either a Glock po, sir, yung depende po, sir, sa kwan sa nananalo po sa bidding because it goes through the bidding po base po sa 918 for Mr. Chairman, sir.
Hindi po ba napakahirap kung iba't ibang klase ng mga baril ang pinoprocure natin, iba't ibang klaseng tatak, iba't ibang klaseng make?
Actually, sir, yun po yung naging problema po natin, sir. That's why we are really trying to negotiate, sir, yung government-to-government na procurement po natin so that magiging isa na lamang po ang magiging issued na baril po ng ating kapulisan, Your Honor, sir.
Tungkol naman dun sa mga balang hindi pumuputok, kumusta naman po yung mga bala natin na minsan hindi pumuputok?
So far naman po, sir, wala na po tayo mga bala, sir, na, no, na hindi po pumuputok because, again, sir, it goes through the process of the bidding process po, sir, and yun pong mga nagpa-participate po dyan ay definitely po, sir, ay may mga test po na kinakandak.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Talagang alam ko naman po na ang interior and local government ay talagang nasa magandang kamay ng ating Secretary Benhur Abalos. Kaya maraming salamat, Secretary.
Okay, thank you salamat very much. Po. So, we recognize from the minority, the last, before we have a break, we will be having a break for 1 hour. After Representative Arlene Brosas. So the Honorable Representative Arlene Brosas is recognized by the chair.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, diretso na po ako kasi 5 minutes lang. Taon-taon, nagdadagdag tayo ng kapulisan. May dinadagdag ding police station sa iba't ibang munisipalidad, pero andito tayo sa punto na napaka-vulnerable at unsafe maglakad sa labas, lalo na para sa mga kababaihan. May we know the interventions made by the PNP on the alarming cases of abductions and gender-based violence against women, ilan po ang naitalang kaso kaugnay nito since July?
Mr. Chair, base po sa record po ng ating DIDM, ang nangyari po ng mga abductions po from July to August as this year ay 3 po ang nasa record po namin, Madam Chair. And as to the intervention po na ginagawa po ng ating kapulisan, with the directive and supervision of our DILG Secretary, sinisiguro po niya na dapat po ang ating mga kapulisan ay nasa, a majority po ay nasa kalsada and yung police presence po nila ay nakikita po ng community that we are serving po.
Madam Chair, I was asking for the update ng interventions ng cases. So ano po ang kalagayan ng mga kaso? Okay. Ng sinasabi ninyo. And can you please enumerate po yung 3 kaso, yung mga pangalan, kung sino-sino?
Madam Chair, as to the 3 cases that transpired for the month of July and August this year, lahat po ng cases na ito ay considered solved na po. For the name of the victims as well as yung mga perpetrators po, I will just provide a copy to the congressman po.
Wala dyan, Madam Chair. Okay. Madam Chair, in the interest of time, pwede pong humingi na lang ng written report ng cases ng abducted, slain women, kung meron po kayo, no? Makuha natin in preparation for the plenary na mga tanong ko po. Tapos, wala po bang social media calls kayong nakukuha kaugnay dito sa mga report ng mga cases? Kasi kahit po kami sa Gabriel, marami kaming natatanggap na reports.
Meron po kaming natatanggap, Madam Chair, and as a matter of fact, yun pong mga naipost po the last I think the last 2 weeks po, we verified po yung mga reported po sa social media, and we found out po na out of the 10 cases po na naipost doon, bali, 6 po doon ay na-solve na po natin, and then meron pa pong 5 na under police investigation po, Your Honor. While the other one, yun pong alleged na kidnapping po sa Bukidnon, it was settled amicably between the suspect and the alleged victim po. So, yun pong mga na-post po sa social media, these are cases of murder po, which was already solved in Malabon. Yung rape with homicide po sa Laguna, involving po dito yung sa Pila, Laguna po, wherein involved po dito ay isang minor, and ang victim is a minor, and the suspect is also a minor. And then yung rape with homicide po sa Bulacan, sa Bustos, na-solve na rin po yun. Na-aresto po yung suspect from San Jose del Monte. Na-aresto po siya doon sa Camarines Sur. And then another murder case sa Bulacan po ay na-solve na rin po.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I will ask for the report na lang nung iba pa. We also note that the budget for the... Nandito po ba yung PCW? Yan. Philippine Commission on Women has been slashed by 12% to just 109 million. Kaya mahirap pong tanggapin namin, no, yung assurances ng DILG, PNP, no, na matitiyak yung protection at safety ng kababaihan kung sa balangkas na ito, meron tayong slashed na 12%, no, sa budget ng PCW. Madam Chair, I would like to know kung ano yung na-slash doon sa...
Madam Chair, if I may be recognized.
Yes,
I'm Christine Chavez, Executive Director of the PCW. To answer the question of Congressperson Rosas, what was cut from our budget is our budget for our operations in Mindanao, because we currently have efforts to localize and regionalize gender mainstreaming in certain regions in Mindanao. What was also cut is our budget for our IT infrastructure to sustain our ECW GAD digital library. So,
thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, importante po yung mga ganyang mga gender mainstreaming, et cetera, no, mga programs na kailangan nating pondohan. So, Madam Chair, sana po ay ma-reconsider yung iba sa mga ito. And for the next question po, Madam Chair, alongside the spate of abductions, the DILG is ramping up the funding for activities related to the NTF-LCAP. Bukod po sa 10 billion barangay development program, may mga alokasyon sa mga program sa DILG at PNP na dapat ipaliwanag sa committee ito. Halimbawa po, yung C4Ps, ito po ay may 453% budget increase mula sa 70 million for 2023. At ang and local communist armed conflict under PNP, 161% increase from 415 million to 1 billion. Kanina po narinig ko naman, inisa-isa yung mga programa, no? Tapos yung PCVEI, 66.67% increase. Now, Madam Chair, we request the PNP to put on record right now what are the activities involved under these programs. Ito pong C4Ps, itong PVEI, no? Yung mga ilan pa po na dapat ipaliwanag natin, Madam Chair.
Sir, may we get a response from the DILG?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good afternoon to everyone once again. Sir, for the C4Ps program, for 2022, we were given a funding allocation of 15 million. For 2023, the 15 million was increased to 85 million. For 2022, the target number of barangays is 959 barangays. For 2023, it increased to 1,414 barangays. So that is the reason why there was an increase in allocation for 2023. The activities to be funded from the Retooled Community Support Program are the engagement of our field operating units with the different barangays that I mentioned, 1,414, conducting consultation with the people in the barangay to identify development gaps and also to identify the development projects that will have to be implemented to address the development gaps and the needs of in the different barangays. Plus, of course, we will be also monitoring the implementation of the support to barangay development programs for our target barangays. Also, as part of the C4 Peace program, we have the Capacitating Urban Communities for Peace and Development, and these are targeted for urbanized areas, particularly our HUCs. We will be engaging the different sectors in these areas, no, to mobilize them to contribute to peace and development in the different target LGUs. Thank you, Madam Chair.
So, do you have a very specific, no, detailed na mga activities niyan? Parang one, pupunta sa community. Second, magbibigay ng, ano yung sinasabi niyo kanina, social services for the community.
Madam Chair, primarily the activities will be consultation and meetings with the members of the community to identify identify the needs, no, in the respective areas.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, tinatanong natin to dahil yung minsan yung target, no, ng kinatawa target, no, dito sa mga ganito kami, no, mga progressive and mga ordinaryong mamamayan, nire-red tag, sinisiraan ng NTF-LCAC. Hindi po natin dapat ponduhan yung mga programa na sumusuporta sa balangkas ng NTF-LCAC at ilipat na lang natin yung pondo sa ayuda para sa mamamayan. Lalo matindi po yung krisis na hinaharap natin ngayon. Lastly, Madam Chair, kasi 26 seconds na lang ako, Madam Chair. This is for the BJMP. We'd like to bring forth the plight of Gian Perez, woman political prisoner po siya, who is currently detained in Taguig City Jail, female dorm, under the jurisdiction of BJMP. She is afflicted with leprosy, Madam Chair. Ngayon, kahit may medical condition si Gian, wala pa rin napapacilitate ng medical treatment sa kanya at nakasiksik pa rin siya sa kulungan kasama ang iba despite the contagious disease. Gayong matindi ang congestion sa Taguig City Jail. Wala bang consideration ang BJMP sa lepers in view of the revised rules of the Board of Pardons and Parole? We actually strongly demand, no, na si Gian be released on humanitarian grounds. Leprosy kasi yun eh, Madam Chair. Maraming salamat. Maraming salamat po. Pasagot lang po yun.
Okay. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Good afternoon. We will look into that. We will find the flight of that PDL, Mr. Chair, and we'll give an update.
Okay, please give us an update, particularly the committee. I'm very interested on that particular issue.
Yes, Madam Chair.
And kindly submit the documents requested by the Honorable Arlene Rosas to the Committee on Appropriation.
Yes, Madam Chair.
So that we can furnish a copy to the Honorable. So
thank you, ma'am, for bringing this matter to our attention.
Thank you. Thank you, too.
Thank you, Madam Chair. For the record, Madam Chair, she is Gian Perez. And every minute counts, actually, for the leprosy. Kasi alam niyo naman po yung leprosy, contagious talaga siya. Kailangan hindi talaga siya kasama ng iba pa. At saka meron talaga medical treatment.
All had been said. Kong, I'll follow that up. So the next to be recognized before... The last, before we have a break, is the Honorable Muhammad Khalid Dimapur.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I'll try to make this as brief and as quick as possible. First, Madam Chair, I'd like to ask the good secretary and also the PNP and the BFP in regards to their convergence programs with the DPWH. I was very disappointed when I went around my district to find that we have several municipal police buildings that are not finished, structural, even no roof. And when people complain, our leaders, our mayors, our barangay captains complain to me To Congressman, ang sagot ko, na COVID lang yan. Maybe because of budgetary constraint in the previous year, the funding was not available to complete the project. So for 2023, Madam Chair, I'd like to request that the DILG, the PNP, and the BFP submit to the committee secretariat what is the budget allocation for phase 2. And sana lang in all of these buildings that are doing, wala nang phase 3. We really have to finish all of these buildings because it is an eyesore. And it looks as if budget disappeared because we had an election year. Secondly, Madam Chair, I'd like to ask the Bureau of Fire to submit to the committee secretariat, how exactly do they distribute fire trucks? Because, it should not be palakasan style. You know, in one municipality, I think our fire truck in Kulambungan, panahon pa ni Ferdinand Marcos. And it's no longer operationable. So there's two instances last year where we had a fire. Nahihirapan ng LGU. And there should be some sort of system for prioritizing how we distribute fire trucks to the municipalities instead of palakasan style. So I'd like to know from the BFP, Madam Chair, they can submit it to the committee secretariat, the guidelines or the system that they have to distribute fire trucks to our MLGUs. Third, Madam Chair, I have been told that local government programs, which are very good and very successful, such as the Calzada program, I don't know what the new name for the BUB or the assistance to disadvantaged municipalities are, have become zero because of the Mandanas ruling. And if it's true that it's zero, I'd like that answer to the committee, Madam Chair. Maybe DILG can submit it to the committee secretariat so I can show it to our governor and mayors na tinood, zero for 2023. But hopefully there's a slip of good news, and that will be in the form of the LGSF. I'd like to appeal to the good secretary, Madam Chair, that we also include in the LGFS, when we work with the municipalities, a good practice that I see in the DSWD for the SIDS Kalahi. They give the LGU a timeline. You have to complete all of these requirements so that we'll be implementation ready, for example, within 3 weeks or 4 weeks or 5 weeks. Because what I've seen in the LGSF, especially over the last year, murag nag ulan ng LGSF sa mga municipalities, they get bogged down. When you have one municipality that has an LGSF, he has not completed the fund, you cannot add additional LGSF. And that will be the problem, a bottleneck. If we are transferring these very nice programs to help our LGUs, which we were doing in the DILG through Calzada, BUB, and etc. to the LGSF, there's that bottleneck problem. And I hope we can sort that out for next year. Last, Madam Chair, I would like to express in a form of manifestation a continuation of Congressman Mujib Hataman's sentiments. You know, this MILF and what happened in Ampatuan, it worries us in Lanao del Norte. So I'd like to get the support of the Chief PNP and the Secretary on this. There is only one real MILF camp in Lanao del Norte, and that is Camp Abubakar in Munay, in the boundary of Munay and Mount Guraen, Lanao del Sur. Itong mga MILF, when the peace agreement happened, they went back to their respective towns. And when they went back to their respective towns, they established so-called camps. So ngayon, may kampo kami sa Salvador, may kampo kami sa Nunungan, may kampo kami sa Tagaluan, may kampo kami sa Balui. And we are fighting this, Madam Chair. And it's reaching, we're not getting any feedback in the higher level. The side of the government, the local government units, the side of the AFP, the Armed Forces of the Philippines, is that these are not MILF camps. These are MILF communities. Our problem, Madam Chair, if it is officially considered as MILF camps, the police cannot enter those areas without proper coordination. So I hope we can get the support of the Secretary and the Chief PNP that these MILF communities that are being claimed by our counterparts in the MILF as camps are not really camps, are not, and that not subject to the ceasefire agreement. That is my personal position and opinion, and I hope we can get the support of the Secretary and the Chief PNP for the province of Lanao del Norte. Okay. Thank you for the time, Madam Chair. Thank you for allowing me to make this manifestation.
Yeah. Yes, if I might answer, Madam Chair.
Yes,
with reference to the last issue, we welcome that. We will work with you with that. We'll raise this immediately with OPAP, with Secretary Galvez. For me, that should really be the position. camps are different from communities, and it must be identified as such. We will support you, sir. With regards to the other issue, the TICAS, it's all DPWH, the funding, the construction, probably the BNP could explain this, sir.
Sir, totoo po yun, sir, na medyo na-pending po lahat yung continuation ng mga convergence projects on the part of the PNP, sir. But we had been communicating with the DPWH, sir, and I think they are going to resume yung construction po ng ating mga police stations, not only in the Mindanao area, sir, in your area, but throughout the country po, sir. Anyway, sir, we'll give you an update, sir, on the part of the municipal police stations that are being constructed through TICAS project of the DPWH, sir.
Okay, and from the BFP?
On the part of the BFP, sir, it is true, sir, that some of the projects are still in phase one. And actually, sir, the completion of the fire stations, natapos na sana, pero may last year kasi, sir, is yung nagka-COVID pandemic na na-return yung pera mula sa BFP, bumalik po sa DBM. But we assure you, sir, that tatapusin po namin yun, sir.
Okay, so that's good. Thank you. So thank you to the DILG. Before the chair will suspend the briefing, may I recognize the presence of Deputy Speaker Raymond. May I acknowledge the presence of DS Raymond Democrito Mendoza. So at this point, the budget briefing is suspended and we resume at 1:40 p.m. this afternoon. Okay, let's have a break.